Obviously, Harold has a reputation of the commission. His hand is a reputation of the commission.
Well, gentlemen, can I welcome you to this meeting of the Scottish Affairs Committee. We've taken the unusual step of meeting in Edinburgh, because obviously Parliament's not sitting at the moment, and we did want to hear the sort of evidence that you have to give us. We're working on the basis that we as a committee want to try and provide information for the people of Scotland about what the possible consequences are of different votes in the referendum. And so far, as you may be aware, we've issued a variety of documents, including our latest document, which is headed No Doubt, No Currency Union. We've taken the view, which I think is understandable, given the very clear and unequivocal statements that have been given to us by leaders of the Labour Party, the Conservative Party and the Liberals, that the UK parties are not, for a variety of reasons, prepared to countenance a shared currency. And in those circumstances, we don't think it's worthwhile going over old ground again. What we want to explore with you is the consequences of each of the alternatives that are available to a shared currency, both in economic terms, but also in terms of what the impact is likely to be both upon industry in Scotland generally and the finance secretary in particular. I mean, I see that there's a particularly silly letter in the Financial Times today from a group saying that, well, you can reopen the issue of a shared currency. I mean, I think our view is that a clear statement has been made and policy has been determined. And those that wish a different policy to be determined are, of course, free to argue that case. But those of us that want to live in the real world and present things to the people of Scotland in terms of what the genuine options are, want, in a sense, really to move on from that. So I wonder if I could just start off by asking if you could just identify us for us what you believe the main alternatives are to a shared currency. Now, I'm conscious with five of you, all of whom are capable of speaking for Scotland, the UK, and indeed the world at some length, we need to try and control this in some way. I'm told that the microphones, only two of them, as well as mine, will work at the one time, so you have to put your microphone on and then off again. Otherwise, I can cancel it if there's any difficulties. I wonder, maybe just start at this end. David, in terms of the alternatives that are available to the people of Scotland in the event of a vote for separation for a currency.
Well, the three alternatives that are talked about are, firstly, joining the euro, which has largely been written off as a possibility. Secondly, Scotland having its own currency, which is a matter of some debate. And thirdly, one that has been talked about quite a lot recently, and I'm sure will engage us this morning, and that's the so-called sterlingisation or dollarisation. Both meaning the same thing, but essentially means adopting sterling as the currency that Scotland would use without any formal currency monetary union with the rest of the UK. So we would no longer, for example, have the Bank of England as our lender of last resort, and so on. So it's This is an issue that has been explored in some detail recently, particularly by a gentleman on my right. But I think probably the two options that we might focus on today would be this sterlingisation and Scotland adopting its own currency.
That's a general view, is it? I mean, we normally quite like if witnesses disagree with each other because that allows us to have more of a debate and hear what the issues are. But I presume in terms of what the alternatives are, there's a consensus that that's the three choices.
Pretty much. I would add to that another form of sterlingisation, which would be a currency board, which has also been articulated, which is in some ways a formalisation of the so-called Panama option or the dollarisation option that David mentioned. So it might be worth touching on that, because that has been advocated by various people as a runner.
But is it, am I right in thinking that that's in a sense a subset of the sterlingisation argument?
I see all three options as basically very similar. The monetary union option, sterlingisation, and the currency board, they're all forms of fixed exchange rates whereby you fix, shall we say, a virtual Scots pound one for one against the remaining UK pound, if you like. So they're all very similar. At their core, they have a fixed exchange rate, but there are subtle differences. Because, for example, with a currency board, you would actually have a monetary authority which may have some control and some supervisory control for the banking system.
Right. Well, maybe I can ask Lindsay if you could pick up the issues relating to sterlingisation first.
Yes, good morning, gentlemen. What does sterlingisation really mean, and how does it work in practice?
Perhaps I can start by trying to explain what it means and how it came about. So the idea of sterlingisation is that sterling would be the legal tender or the legal currency for an independent Scotland. That's the idea. Now, you could be forgiven for thinking that that's already the case, but there's a distinction here between the Scottish notes that currently circulate and Bank of England notes that circulate. Now, the way things currently work is that Scottish notes circulate, they're issued by the three commercial banks, but they're all backed up and managed by the Bank of England. So the Bank of England manages this process. This is clarified in the 2009 Finance Act, Section 6. Okay, so it's managed by the Bank of England. Now, if Scotland becomes independent, then it would be quite unusual for the Bank of England to say, well, we're still going to manage what would become a different country's currency. They could be reasonably expected to say, we're not taking on this role anymore because it's somebody else's currency. And at that point, Scotland or the Scottish government would have to decide what's it going to do in terms of its currency, and that's where it gets confronted with a choice. Now, one choice is that it creates either its own new Scottish notes and buys the Scottish notes existing and exchanges them for new Scottish notes, and then it becomes a currency board. That's one option. So you still have a distinctive Scottish currency, but then it becomes a Scottish government currency, not the Bank of England currency. Or you say, we're actually going to buy back these Scottish notes and just accept English notes circulating and say, we no longer have a Scottish currency. So you've got a choice. The currency board choice is you still have Scottish notes, but then you tie them to the English notes, and it'd be the Scottish government doing the tying, not the English government doing, not the rest of the UK government doing the tying. That's one option. The sterlingisation option is that you simply no longer have Scottish notes, you just have rest of UK currency. And now it's just as if you were effectively a region of the rest of the UK from a monetary point of view. Just like the North East uses sterling, Scotland would be using sterling, but of course Scotland would be a different country at this point.
Where does pegging link into a currency board and sterlingisation?
Well, with the currency board, the Scottish notes would be pegged, tied, the value would be tied to the value of the Bank of England notes, presumably a one-to-one. With sterlingisation, there's no need to peg anything because all you've got is Bank of England notes. You just have Bank of England notes. That would be the sterlingisation option.
Who would be on the currency board and what would be their status?
I'm sorry?
Who would be on the currency board and what would be their status?
Well, the currency board at this point would be operated under the Scottish Government, and the Scottish Government presumably would create a monetary authority because it's required to join Europe. So it'd have a monetary authority, and one of the parts of the monetary authority would be the currency board, which is usually a statutory part of the board. So it's a legal requirement that you create this and say this is how this thing operates, it has full backing. But the overall management of it will be, at the highest level, the new independent Scottish Government, and no longer what it currently is, which is the Bank of England, does the managing of the issuance of the Scottish notes. So a fundamental change on who manages this thing.
In the event of a yes vote, then, and no formal currency union, how would this transition be managed from a currency union to sterlingisation?
So in the event of a yes vote, given that the parties of the Westminster Parliament have expressed the view that there will be no formal monetary union, given that, something will have to change to go from where we currently are to where we'd be tomorrow. My view of what they would change is that they would issue primary legislation to change the 2009 Act, in effect to say the Bank of England no longer oversees the management and takes responsibility for the issuance of Scottish notes. And when you think about that, that'd be, if you don't want to have a monetary union, that'd be the reasonable thing to do, because why would you manage the currency of another country? Clearly, the rest of the UK's interest is going to be to say, assuming Scotland has become independent, is to say we are no longer responsible for any liability of the Scottish Government from here onwards. And so one way to do that is say, we're not managing the currency, and that would require primary legislation which the UK would be able to introduce to change the 2009 Act.
So it ceased to be the lender of last resort?
Well, we have to be very careful. That's a big question. We have to be very careful. So do we want to go into lender of last resort now? Because it's a big question. I'm very happy to. Essentially, lender of last resort.
Well, let's come back to that later.
Yeah, okay, come back to that.
Can you give us examples of where sterlingisation, or dollarisation as it's called, is currently practiced, and what the impact has been on the economies of these countries?
Well, there tends to be two types of state where there is dollarisation is the sort of vernacular for this type of currency arrangement. You can use euros, you can use Aussie dollars, you can use US dollars, lots of different currencies tend to be called dollarisation. So one type of country is a city-state. Liechtenstein, Monaco, Luxembourg, so very, very small places. So those countries, the Vatican, those countries which are legal countries, independent countries, they dollarize and they get special dispensation usually because they're so small. And then the other extreme, you've got bigger countries which dollarize typically because they have tried to find a way of stabilizing their country and their economic situation. So the four that have got a decent sized economies, you know, by which we're talking millions of people rather than tens of thousands, Panama, which dollarized in 1904, longest serving country, Ecuador and El Salvador, they dollarize at the end of the last century, so 1999, 2000, 2001 sort of time. Liberia had a high degree of dollarization, but then became de-dollarized. It was never quite formal, I don't think. So you have a number of countries which have had a high level of dollarization, then backed off. But the main ones that have officially dollarized, Panama, Ecuador, and then El Salvador, are the large ones. Montenegro is the next one down in terms of size.
Why have they gone for dollarization, and what impact has it had on their economy?
Well, the big ones, so just looking at the big ones first of all, I mean, for some of the small ones, it really is the pure convenience, and the country next door to it that it dollarized too, it was the pure inconvenience of not having a role, they tend not to have monetary authority and so on. The bigger countries have dollarized in an attempt to try and stabilize their economies. So If we take Ecuador had a huge debt restructuring in the 1990s. It then had another, restructuring's a euphemism, by the way, for default. They had another restructuring in, I think, 06 or 07, 2006, 2007. So this is not, so Ecuador did it because they had a lot of economic troubles, a lot of foreign debt, and they used this as a way of defaulting on their debt without having huge currency issues at the same time, because they don't have a currency, they're using the dollar. Panama has used the dollar, as I say, since 1904. It should be pointed out that between 1970 and 2000, Panama was second only, I think, to Pakistan in having the highest number of IMF packages in the world. So again, not really a panacea. El Salvador's fared better. In El Salvador, there was political difficulties and economic difficulties which led them to bring it in, but they've had a better, it's had better results for them. So those are the main examples. As I say, it tends to move you away from currency risk because you don't have a currency, but it doesn't disappear. It becomes credit risk. It becomes, well, can your country actually pay its debts? And what we've tended to see is some of these countries have continued to have debt repayment problems. But then I think it's important to point out that these countries were already in difficult economic situations before they made these currency judgments.
Okay, if they have debt-related problems, what happens to interest rates and borrowing rates?
It depends on the economic situation of each country. I think one has to take the countries in their context, but overall the effect is you no longer have currency risk because, quite simply, you don't have your own currency, you're using the US dollar. But that risk gets transformed into another area, and it becomes the credit risk. It becomes the risk that you can't repay in dollars rather than you can't repay in your own currency. And as I mentioned, some of those countries which have been dollarized have, before they dollarized, had a history of debt default and restructuring. But even after being dollarized, they still continue to do so, in particular Panama. Now, again, it's important to put into context these countries have a lot of other economic problems. And so I wouldn't like to leave the suggestion that the act of becoming dollarized led to these defaults. They presumably would have had problems without being dollarized. That's why they got into this difficult situation. And one final point I made, when I say that these countries have become officially dollarized, just to make this position slightly more complicated, they also have their own coins quite often, which trade. So it's not as though they don't have their own coins. So they do. But their official currency for writing checks, for making payments, for doing any sort of reasonable size transaction is the US dollar.
Would it be fair to say then that those countries that have dollarized have been in constant financial crisis? Or regular financial crisis?
I'd say two things. First, those countries were in financial crisis before they dollarized.
Yeah.
And after they dollarized, they have continued to have financial problems. Dollarized countries, Ecuador and Panama, have defaulted while they've been dollarized countries. There is empirical evidence to suggest that, so published economic empirical evidence to suggest that dollarized countries have more financial instability than non-dollarized countries. That is fair to say.
Okay, can we move on to the implications of sterlingization on the banks here? Dr. Kelly.
Well, specifically for the banks, if we went down the sterlingization route, then I suppose I defer to the much bigger and much better resource. Oh, thank you very much, sorry. I defer, I think, to the big sort of guns in our industry who've been looking at these issues, but, and I don't mean our own members, I mean Deutsche Bank, Fathom, Barclays Foreign Exchange, Exxon BNP Paribas, Credit Agricole, BlackRock, Citi, Commerzbank, UBS, UBS Chief Economist, Credit Suisse, quite a long list of very big names who have looked at these issues genuinely dispassionately. They're not companies that have any particular political interest in Scotland. This is analysis by some of the top names in the industry, and I've really just brought them all to one place to see what the consensus is.
This is a collation of expert opinion.
In my opinion, yes, yeah. And I think it's what the financial markets are looking at to the extent that they are pricing in the possibility of a yes vote. And I think the clear consensus that comes through that is that firstly, going back to the original point made by the chairman, that a currency union, the views range from highly unlikely to simply unfeasible. So I think, you know, the starting point would be that a currency union isn't going to happen. That's the clear consensus. But on the other options, I think the consensus is that the most likely outcome would be sterlingisation in the short term with a new currency in the medium to long term. And I'm simply reflecting what's said by the industry rather than analysis we've done at our own hand, not that we'd be in a place to do that. In terms of the impact of both of those would be that there would be an expectation that the banks would have to consider their domicile to ensure that they had, and you hinted at it earlier, the proper support through lender of last resort and indeed stability. So I think if we looked at the sterlingisation and indeed new currency impacts, then there would, according to this analysis, be pressure for the banks to consider their domicile.
Okay, that's quite a serious situation. What about interest rates and borrowing rates?
Sorry, before we go on, can I just clarify for the record what this question of reconsider their domicile actually means for real people? What's the effect of reconsidering? And secondly, what's the effect of changing your domicile?
Well, it's difficult to generalise because all banks and all financial companies are different, but there's a number of reasons why, if Scotland becomes a separate jurisdiction for regulatory purposes and tax purposes, regardless of the currency question, that all these things are interrelated, then companies would have to consider where would they best be located in order to serve the customer base on which their continued success is based. So in answer to your question, what impact does it have? I mean, it was interesting. There was an article yesterday in the FT by Sir George Matheson making the point that, in his view, it's his view rather than mine, to a large extent, the largest Scottish banks, by which I suppose I mean Lloyds and RBS, have sort of already moved anyway. Therefore, it's kind of, you know, it's a process that's already happened. And he refers as well to the ownership of, or the part ownership of those institutions by the UK government. But I think if you did see that kind of move, you would see it having an impact not only in terms of jobs, but also in terms of influence and the other supporting professional activities, for example, which having, you know, sizable banking operations in Scotland gives us.
Can I just be clear what domicile means in that regard? I mean, there's blocks of flats in the Cayman Islands which are almost collapsing under the weight of brass plates. So, you know, they have domiciles of various companies. Now, surely companies in Scotland could just simply move their brass plates and continue to work on in Scotland.
There's different aspects to this, and probably more expert people than I am on this panel. But one aspect is, if you wish to continue to serve the 90% of your customers who are in the rest of the UK, you have to comply with the regulatory requirements and expectations of the rest of the UK. So, for example, there are plenty of banks which are foreign operating in the UK to serve all those customers, but they have to comply with the requirements of the FCA as it's currently set up, which means you have to have certain sizes of operations and you have to have some operations within the jurisdiction that is being regulated. So there's a regulatory aspect to it. There's also a market aspect to it. If you want to serve those 90%, you have to be compliant fully with the Financial Services Compensation Scheme and other requirements like that. So there are some sort of things you have to do within the jurisdiction you're serving. Now, that's the sort of domestic market question. The sort of, I suspect, as I say, much more expert people with an eye on this, but the lender of last resort question, that is the question of where is your bank domiciled for the purposes of state support of various kinds, whether that's liquidity support in times of when there's a liquidity problem, or whether it's, you know, bailout, sort of, you know, the sort of investments that have been made by the UK government in RBS, for example, that, I think, does hinge very heavily on where you are domiciled. Now, my own understanding, I've often heard it said, that this isn't really a problem, because when there's a crisis, foreign governments quite happily sort of, you know, fund banks in trouble. Look what happened, so the argument goes, to RBS in America. Look what happened to companies, to banks who are sort of funded by foreign governments. My understanding is, and others will be far more expert than I, is that there's a big difference between liquidity support in times of acute crisis, where the central bank is really giving short-term lending to tide a bank over a kind of, you know, it's like a bridging loan. That is one situation where I think the operations, where the operations are happening, is the defining factor. But when it comes to bailout, then I think that really depends on where you are registered and headquartered, and I think that's a distinction.
Can I just, if I could just continue this question of domicile, because when surely the Scottish whiskey industry, for example, would say that it is selling, I mean, this is more a point for Ewan as well, but I mean, it's selling all over the world, and therefore it's able to cope with all the rules and regulations about health and safety and you know, whatever is necessary. They're able to do it from a base in Scotland. Why should the finance industry be any different? I mean, even though they have to comply with the rules on selling in the rest of the UK, why are they not able to do that from Edinburgh? And therefore, it would just simply be another one of the, you know, multivarious markets that they're targeting.
Well, as I say, because it's, I think the compliance requirements are jurisdiction based. So if you, it would be possible indeed to run a big international bank from a small country like, a small market like Scotland. But if you wanted to serve other markets, you have to comply with their requirements. So a good example would be HSBC, headquartered in London, registered there, but serving markets all over the world. Standard Chartered would be an even better example. I think they have no business at all in the UK, but all their business is overseas. However, the capitalisation of their operations and what sits behind it is done on a country by country, on a jurisdictional basis, increasingly. But as I say, in times of acute crisis, when you're talking about bailouts, it's the home state which is headquartered, which is the
I understand plan. The point about bailouts in extreme circumstances, and we'll maybe come back to that later on. But in terms of what difference this actually makes, trading in different locations, you know, surely it doesn't actually make all that much of a difference if you're able to comply with regulations in France or England or the United States from a base in Scotland, then separation will not make any difference at all, effectively, in job terms.
But the difference for our members, compared with the current situation, is that you have to comply twice over. At the moment, you do it once for the market of 70 million. If you have to do it for two separate jurisdictions, you have to comply separately. So, as I say, if you were serving the rest of the UK from a base in Scotland, you would have to invest in things that met the requirements of the FCA and the Bank of England. So that would not only be levels of management and other activities, you would have to make sure you had the right capital support, and you also had the you could play your part in the financial services compensation scheme. So there are clear compliance costs, sort of fixed costs, operating in a jurisdiction. Depending on the nature of your activity, they can be large or small, or particularly impact your bottom line or not. But nonetheless, it is there is a difference between complying separately for two markets and complying for one.
But this point about clear compliance costs might be clear to you, but I'm afraid it's not clear to me. I mean, you know, what is the scale of clear compliance costs? I mean, are we talking about 1%, 0.5%, 0.1%, 20%? I mean, how many jobs would have to be transferred? One man out of 10,000 or woman out of 10,000? I mean, to give us a... If people outside who are not experts in the worlds of high finance and would tend to steer away from it where possible are trying to grasp this issue, what do they put their hand on, I mean, to try and identify what the negative or positive impact would be?
I think what people tend to quite rightly, focus on is jobs, because that's right. When we talk about our industry, we talk about 100,000 people working in it, and that's the figure we tend to refer to. It's not possible to say how many of those jobs are serving UK customers, but I think it is reasonable to observe that the big battalions in that 100,000 are in banking, pensions and insurance. Asset management, for example, vitally important part of our industry, but the numbers of employees, however influential it is in world markets and investment decisions and other things, if you're just looking at job numbers, it's a relatively small proportion, probably fewer than 10,000. So a comparison that one could usefully make perhaps is with Ireland. So Ireland, an admirable jurisdiction who, you know, have had fantastic success, particularly in attracting international financial services activity. The Irish financial services industry in total employs about 60,000 people. That's the total. Roughly half of those are working in international financial services. This is the business of servicing financial transactions from all around the world. So this is companies like HSBC and Citi and JP Morgan, you know, big names running big operations. And we have a good share of that here in Scotland. However, it's 60,000 as against 100,000. Now, to some extent, that difference is reflected by the fact that our industry is serving the larger market of 70 million. So quite a lot of the jobs will be serving UK customers, reflecting the fact, as you know and this committee knows well, 90% of the customers that our industries within the UK market are not in Scotland, they're in the rest of the UK. So I would say, and I'm trying to answer your question, if you're looking at job numbers, we would make a transition from being part of a large jurisdiction serving a large market to being a jurisdiction serving a much smaller customer base at the domestic level. Now, you might argue, and I think I saw a letter in the FT or yesterday or today, arguing that actually, if Scotland were a separate jurisdiction, it could make it much more attractive for asset managers and fund managers to come and operate. That's a hypothetical possibility, of course, but it is, I think, the opportunity that people are generally referring to when they talk about the opportunities that come for financial services from a move to independence. It's the possibility that you could create a more attractive environment for tax and regulatory reasons. I could see that as a theoretical possibility. There'll be many different views on how likely it is to materialise, but as a theoretical possibility, it clearly exists. However, as I say, if you're thinking about big battalions and job numbers, they won't come through asset management and fund management. The job numbers tend to come through the mass provision of services to large markets.
Yes, but I think unless I've missed the point, I still haven't grasped whether or not that would mean that the 100,000 jobs in Scotland serving the finance industry at the moment would have to become, like the Irish example, 30-30, and therefore a lot of those jobs would move away, or whether or not, you know, some other scenario. You know, give us a figure. You know, I mean, are you saying that with sterlingisation, all bar 10 jobs would remain in Scotland, or are you saying that after sterlingisation, only 10 jobs would remain?
I can't give a figure because it's actually very difficult to break down the industry into those categories. However, I can quote Exane BNP Paribas, a big French investment bank. They estimate that the financial services industry is unlikely to survive in its present guise, and they estimate that between 20,000 to 40,000 jobs would migrate to the rest of the UK. I don't know what they base that on, but that's the only estimate I've seen.
Right. That'd be 20,000 to 40,000 job loss potentially.
That's according to Exane BNP Paribas. That's not right. A figure that we have come
okay.
up with.
Okay, back to you, Lindsay.
Yeah, can we just pick up on the issue of sterlingisation and interest in mortgage rates? Is there likely to be an impact?
Sterlingisation?
Yeah.
I think from that point of view, from the perspective of the industry, I mean, if there is a yes vote, there is inevitably going to be a period of currency uncertainty. Even if, without dragging us back to the previous conversation, one believes, as some do, that there would be a currency union, that would take time to negotiate. So there will be a period of time where we won't know what the currency future is, and that will have to be managed. And obviously there are plenty of examples of how people manage currency uncertainty. On the specific question of sterlingisation, if we moved to that that state, I think there would be a number of issues. One would be, as you've already raised, and we may come back to lender of last resort. The other big issue, which I think Professor Armstrong did touch on, is if you operate a sterlingisation system, I think there'd be some very tricky relationships and negotiations to be had with the EU. I don't know, others much more expert than I am on this, I don't know if it's really been tested whether using another country's currency on the basis of a sterlingisation model would be compatible with the EU treaties. I think that's an open question. I don't know the answer to it. There is stuff in the treaties about having to comply with frameworks around central banks and so on. Could you comply without having a central bank in the normal sense? I think at the minimum it would be a matter for negotiation, and it could actually be quite problematic. The other issue, which again hasn't really been aired, is that if you have sterlingisation situation, it compares a little with the Montenegro situation, where they are negotiating accession to the EU. One of the issues for them, and I've looked into this and discussed it with some people, I don't think there's an expectation that this issue will be resolved over the next for quickly. The process doesn't allow that, but it is certainly a question whether they, as users of the euro on a dollarized basis, can comply with the treaties. Now, it sort of feels a bit unlikely that they would be prevented from joining the EU on the basis that they were already using the euro, but sort of on the wrong basis. But the map that would take them through that process is yet to be drawn up.
Could I just add to that on the Montenegro issue, yeah. Indeed, to what... And what Angus was saying, I mean, all of the countries that Angus mentioned as examples are very small countries relative to the home country, if you like. So Panama, its GDP relative to the US's GDP is something like 0.002%. Montenegro is even less. So it's like a fly on the back of an elephant. But the situation in the UK would be completely new territory because Scotland's GDP, an independent Scotland's GDP as a proportion of remaining UK, would be ballpark 10%. Now that's a very significant number. And when people propose the sterlingisation option, what they're doing is focusing on the supply of money, the amount of money that's out there. But as economists, it'd be remiss of us not to point out there's a demand for money. And it's well known in what we call the currency substitution literature, where you substitute another currency for your own currency, that this creates very unstable expectations, and it creates shifts in demand for money, which makes the control of the money supply quite difficult. And so I think this adds another layer of uncertainty to the whole sterlingisation issue, which really hasn't been brought out. I don't think the Bank of England, frankly, would be passive if Scotland decided to adopt sterling anyway. I think because of the size of the Scottish economy vis-a-vis the rest of the UK, I think there'd be important issues of monetary control going on there. So that really reinforces the point I think Owen Kelly was making, that this is unlikely to fit in with EU regulations.
Could I just clarify, when you say the Bank of England is unlikely to be passive, what does being not passive mean?
Well, it's got its own, at the moment it's inflation targeting, or it was, it's inflation targeting. So if people are switching money balances around the UK, if they're switching current accounts, and they may start to switch sterling balances overseas, which could affect sterling, and this is the big issue in these kind of currency substitution situations, that starts to make, because Scotland's a relatively big economy, that starts to make the control of the money supply by the Bank of England an issue. So their targets, their inflation targets, become much more difficult to control if people are uncertain about the future of what's going to happen in Scotland. If people are starting to move their funds to remaining UK, but also across to the Eurozone, for example.
Right, that's the nature of the problem. But you indicated that the Bank of England would not remain passive. And if they're not passive, presumably then they're doing something. Yeah. What would they do?
Well, it depends on the circumstances. They may have to alter the quantity of money in the economy, which could have spillover effects to what's happening in Scotland, because we would have no control over, obviously, the control of the money supply. They're going to, as they always have done in a monetary union, focus on the remaining UK, control of inflation in the remaining UK. Inflation in Scotland is going to be moving in completely different directions to what's happening in the remaining UK. So their reaction to an unstable situation in Scotland is going to exacerbate any attempts to control inflation in Scotland, if that is in fact possible in a sterlingisation setup.
But can I just clarify whether or not the action that the Bank of England would take in those circumstances to react to something happening on its borders would be any different to the sort of action that it would take to something happening, say, in the United States or in the Eurozone? I mean, they would respond to economic circumstances around them and take various actions to protect their home base. Would there be anything distinctive and different about the action that they would take if it was Scotland using sterling as compared to just simply to reacting to events?
Yes, I believe it would be, because the sterlingisation option that we've mentioned is not a stable solution. It, for the same reasons that a formal monetary union is not a stable solution. So everybody knows that's not going to last. Now, financial markets bring the future forward because it's in their interest so to do. So there'd be huge uncertainty if we adopt sterling, partly for the reasons I've mentioned just now, but also because it's not a tenable exchange rate regime for an independent Scotland, given the structure of a post-independent Scotland. So if I were sitting in Scotland with a bank account, I would be uncertain as to whether we're going to adopt the euro. So if I'm uncertain about that, I may be moving a proportion of my funds to the euro area. Now, if you think of all actors in Scotland making these decisions and transferring bank accounts or proportions of their bank accounts to, say, the eurozone, that is very different to what would be happening in the UK today in terms of the example you gave. And it would have consequences for sterling, which would have consequences for inflation, which would then have consequences for what the Bank of England did.
Would it be a sensible and rational position for people who had bank accounts in Scotland, which perhaps are not necessarily as large as yours, to move their money somewhere else at the moment?
I believe it would. Any uncertainty over what your assets are going to be denominated in will lead rational actors, whether they be individuals or companies, to move their funds over into other jurisdictions. And I believe that is indeed happening. Yeah.
So at the moment, sorry, can I just be clear about that? You're saying that that's actually happening at the moment, that individuals and corporate actors are actually moving balances out of Scotland and Scottish institutions into institutions elsewhere?
Yes, I have spoken to CEOs of companies based in Scotland who have moved all of their capital out of Scotland in advance of the referendum. Yep.
And that's a rational thing for individuals to do?
I believe it is, because of the uncertainty, uncertain expectations about what's going to happen in the future and what your assets and indeed your liabilities are going to be denominated in the future.
I'm tempted to ask you where you think we should move it to, but you're not a financial advisor, and this is not necessarily the circumstances in which to do that. Can I just clarify, just on this particular point about people moving balances, companies and individuals moving balances abroad? I mean, firstly, is that the experience or your understanding as well from the rest of the panel? And secondly, do you agree that that's a rational thing for people in these circumstances to do? I mean, people don't need to tell us how much is in their balances, but just to give us an indication.
It's the have you got a bank account in England question.
This is moving money across borders is something called capital flight. Mm-hmm. Now, at the moment, there is a border called the Scottish borders between England and Scotland, but there's no economic border for any intents and purposes. If Scotland becomes independent, then there becomes an economic border. It doesn't mean you have to build a big wall, but it becomes an economic border, because companies that serve the whole of the United Kingdom have to decide where they want to put their registered office. So this gets back to the issue of domicile. So you have to have an incorporation or office of registration in Companies House. This is not a sort of warm term which is vague. You have to name an office you're incorporated, where you are incorporated or registered at Companies House. You can't be in two places at once. So you're going to have to decide which country, so to speak, because you now have two independent sovereign states, which one of those two are you going to put your offices? So it becomes important. And those flows that go between those two countries currently, which are called within UK flows, become cross-border flows. Okay, so they become international transactions. So when Luxembourg wanted to join the euro area, it had to create its own new balance of payments figures, as Scotland will have to have its own balance of payments figures. And its exports of financial services to the rest of the UK become exports of goods and services to what will become a foreign country. And so it does matter where you, have your business, where you locate your businesses, but also the place of your registered or incorporated office matters, because that is where you're going to be regulated by. Okay, so it is profoundly important. It has to be made clear. This is not an issue of brass plates. This is an issue of you have to have an incorporated office or registered office in one jurisdiction or the other for one legal body. So that matters for who's going to regulate you. Now, once you've decided that you have your incorporated office, you can, of course, create a branch or subsidiary in lots of other countries. Of course you can. Branches and subsidiaries have very different meanings. If you're a subsidiary, then you're regulated by the country that subsidiary is based in. The deposit insurance is provided by the country that you're based in, and it's legally protected in that country that the subsidiary is based in. If you're a branch, those things are not the same. You're not regulated, you're regulated by the home country. Your deposit insurance is not provided by that country, provided by that home country, and so on. So they're very different models, very important to be clear on what people are talking about. Now, this gets to the question of what should you do with your money? Well, it depends whether it's going to be a branch or a subsidiary in a foreign country. So this is, these are the technicalities that actually start to matter. One thing I think that one can say is that the period between the vote and when Scotland would become an independent country, then in that period, then until there's legislative changes, then everything continues to be the UK. An independent Scotland would not have been created at that point, so there's no need to do anything because it would all be under UK regulation. You'd have UK deposit insurance, UK regulation, and so on and so forth. After Scotland became legally independent and the acts had been changed, because you have to have the acts to change these things, then you have different legal constituents, and that's when people have to decide, do they think that the deposit insurance in an independent Scotland is the same as a deposit insurance in the rest of the UK? That's for people to decide.
Professor Bell, I wonder if I could turn to you.
Yeah.
About externalisation and Scotland's public finances and borrowing. What would be the impact here?
Well, I mean, I think this, in a sense, comes sort of indirectly by this issue of lender of last resort,
yeah,
and how Scotland would be perceived by the financial markets. And essentially, if you don't have a lender of last resort, then somehow or other, a fund has to be built up in order to deal with liquidity crises of financial institutions that are still based in your jurisdiction. So you don't have the Bank of England, you have to have something different. And what it could be, one possibility, and one that's used elsewhere, or indirectly used elsewhere, is the strength of the government's balance sheet.
Yeah.
And that a strong government balance sheet means running a budget surplus, which means that tax revenues exceed spending, which means that we would be in a situation different from that which we are in now, where spending for a Scottish government, and indeed, you know, the UK is not in a markedly better position, but Scotland would be a relatively small country. That's one important difference. But nevertheless, so spending in Scotland exceeds revenues by around, let's say, 8% at the moment. So you'd have to go from that situation to one where you start to think about building up a fund which ultimately is a fund that is there to protect your own financial institutions because you haven't got a lender of last resort. And actually, in the current fiscal situation, it would take some time to build up such a fund because you've got to get to the starting block before you can start to build up the fund.
How would that be done? What would be the implications for services and taxation? And
So it would require a pretty strong fiscal constraints, which is one way of describing, you know, cutting spending and finding every possible way you can to increase tax revenue.
So an austerity programme?
Well, it could be. Of course, one can go too far with austerity programmes and end up cutting off demand so much that the fall in spending actually causes your revenues to drop as well. So it would, but it would not mean a period where you could do anything other than be very, very careful with the public finances.
Right. And John Swinney says he's willing to borrow $2.4 billion. To tackle poverty and the agenda we have at the moment of an adverse situation, austerity programme and so on. What's that likely to mean?
Well, if it led to a greater increase in tax revenues than the increase in spending, it would be okay. And then that becomes a question, would that happen? I mean, I guess my presumption is that it probably wouldn't.
Yeah.
And that puts further into the future the possibility of building up this fund that you might need to protect your financial institutions.
Okay, several commentators have said that sterlingisation would be a disaster for Scotland. Is that your view? Or what are the key components, the key uncertainties that would make it very difficult to project how Scotland would perform?
Well, can I just say one thing? Ronnie mentioned earlier, you know, effectively what we would have as sterlingisation is a fixed exchange rate between Scotland and the rest of the UK. Now, the question is, post-independence, would that be appropriate to have a fixed exchange rate? And if it's not, Scotland might be losing out in competitiveness, which would mean that its long-term growth prospects might be affected. Now, there's an issue about whether oil itself, because it's relatively important to the Scottish economy, much more important to the Scottish economy than to the UK as a whole, suggests that there ought to be a different exchange rate between Scotland and the rest of the UK. A fixed exchange rate works so long as you've got broadly the same level of productivity and you're trading a lot together. It's not entirely clear, especially if Scotland takes off in relation to its productivity growth, which is one of the scenarios that the Scottish government has put forward, then that a fixed exchange rate would still be appropriate. So I guess that would be my key concern, whether over the medium to long term, unless the Scottish economy pretty much mirrors what's going on in the rest of the UK, would a fixed exchange rate, i.e. sterlingisation, continue to be an appropriate policy?
I think my concern would be that it wouldn't just be a medium to longer term issue, it would be a short-term issue because of the oil effect that David mentioned. I mean, this for me is the biggie with respect to designing any sensible exchange rate regime for an independent Scotland, because it becomes a petrocurrency as soon as you become independent. That happens not in the medium term, the long term, that happens in day one. Now, there are a number of channels through which that will affect the exchange rate. The most important one is the terms of trade. That's your exports as a proportion of your imports. That's a relative price. Prices move quickly. Prices move on the day of independence. Mm. So that effect kicks in immediately. And therefore, the regime, any form of fixed regime that you care to pick, whether it be a formal monetary union or, as David said, the sterlingization options that we mentioned, all of these immediately become inappropriate because you're a petrocurrency. Mm. Add on to that, other issues of productivity divergences, which I believe would happen endogenously, but also the Scottish Government has explicitly said it wants that to diverge. That's another well-known driver of a country's competitiveness or relative inflation. So all of these factors taken together mean that day one of independence, any of these sterlingisation options is not a realistic or credible option, and it's bound to fail.
Yeah, especially so since the number of people engaged in college education, vocational schools, is very low. In fact, in my own authority, in 5 years, it's reduced from 40,000 to 16,000. So we have a low skill economy relative terms to some other areas of the UK.
Well, that may be, but this issue is more about price effects and competitiveness effects rather than our skill set. But I believe in the longer term, that would have an additional effect as well. Yeah. But and I think the other point to make on currencies, which I mentioned earlier, is that, you know, financial markets bring the medium and long term forward to today. It's in their interest so to do, because if they believe they're going to make a capital gain or capital loss by taking a particular position with a currency, they're not going to wait till the medium term. They're going to bring about that crisis today. And I think that is a very important point to be recognised in this whole debate, that unless you get the exchange rate regime right on day one, there would be, I believe, economic chaos in Scotland post-independence.
When you say crisis, what kind of crisis?
Well, if you were adopting sterling, you would have I think sterling would start to go through the floor, basically, because of the uncertainty that would be creating. There would be capital flight, as we've mentioned, away from Scotland. I don't think you would need to wait until you sorted out the jurisdiction issue. I think it would be in people's interest to move funds more or less immediately, because they could see or will see that that regime is not credible. And people can also issue financial instruments to take positions on an independent Scotland, which could be very, very significant.
Ian, have you any comment to make on that?
I think the first thing to say is that the CBI has not done any detailed, really detailed research on these four options. I mean, we know what their characteristics are. Our members tell us that they have concerns about the four options. They do introduce a great deal of uncertainty into the business community. I mean, that shouldn't surprise any of us from what we've heard from my colleagues here this morning. But our view goes back to, you know, the best thing for Scotland would be a formal currency union, but that can only take place if the United Kingdom remains intact. The Scottish Government, their proposition is that that will remain, but the UK Government and the opposition parties have ruled that out. So it's a very, very uncertain situation for business. And then when one compounds that, you know, Owen Kelly spoke about regulation and issues around that. It goes further than that, of course, because at the moment in the United Kingdom, we have broadly a common set of laws and rules that businesses operate under, whether it's company law, very extensive and detailed corporate governance rules nowadays, taxation, employment law, health and safety law, and so on. when a country becomes independent, if Scotland were to do that, then over time it's likely, as politicians react in legislators to events that happen, that these common laws and rules would start to diverge and cause more cost for business across the two different jurisdictions.
Okay, that's very helpful, thank you.
Mike, you wanted to raise a point.
Yes, we've dealt quite extensively with sterilisation, but I just wanted to bring up one point before we move on to something else. And if it goes back to the right,
it was this side of the that we're hogging the microphones. Never mind, we've moved on now. As I was saying, we've dealt quite extensively with sterilisation, but I just wanted to go right back really to something that Dr. Armstrong said, because you listed the countries that have used dollarisation, and you painted quite a bleak picture of the likelihood of it working. And indeed, Professor McDonald, you backed that up, saying sterilisation isn't a long-term solution for an economy of our type. But the country that we haven't talked about, and perhaps it's because you were dealing with sterilisation rather than a currency board, is Hong Kong. And that's always the one that is held up as being, we could be like Hong Kong, and that would work on a long-term basis. It's a similar type of economy. It's a complex economy. It's one which has a lot of financial services. That then would be a viable model for Scotland going forward. So, can we deal with that part of sterilisation, which we haven't touched on?
Yes, you're absolutely right, and completely correct to bring that up. The difference is something which, in our research, we have tried to bring out as the, for us, is the most important issue, which is called debt. Hong Kong has, since the currency board was started, had almost unbroken string of fiscal surpluses. A remarkable record by anybody's measure, which means that it has fiscal reserves, not a debt, reserves of about, I think they're about 30% of GDP. That's the fiscal reserves that it can use to do lend of last resort and so on, in fact, do anything it decides to choose to do. And then, of course, it has its foreign exchange reserves. And Hong Kong's foreign exchange reserves are over $300 billion. I think an independent Scotland got a population share of the UK reserves. The UK reserves are about 70 billion. Hong Kong's are 300. I presume you get 10% of 70. Seems a reasonable approach. So they are completely different. So the big difference for Hong Kong, and why Hong Kong can do these things, you're completely correct. It has lend of last resort, and yet it basically pegs itself to somebody else's currency. It can use stabilisation measures. It has China making huge differences to its flows in and out of its border. Why can it do all of these things? It can do these things because it has enormous reserves which have come through 30 years of fiscal prudence and saving. And absolutely, if a country is in that position, you can do these things. If you do not start from that position, you start from the position of taking a reasonable, fair share of the existing UK debt, then you're more likely to start off with an 80% debt to GDP ratio rather than having all of these reserves. That's why they are so completely different, because the debt position you start from is absolutely different. And if I may say, the reason why, compared to Ronnie and David, I have come in a slightly different position, but I think we've probably all recognize this point. For Ronnie, the volatility of oil is a key factor in his prognosis. I completely accept that. If you had huge amounts of fiscal savings and reserves, you could perhaps manage some of that, if you had huge amounts of fiscal savings and reserves. For David, to build up the reserves you need to do lend of last resort, then you'd have to have lots of surpluses. But if you had the savings, the reserves already, you could do that as well. But unless there's something I don't know, there are not all of these reserves hanging around. The UK overall is not in a strong fiscal position. It's debt to GDP ratio is almost 90, expected to be about 90% of GDP in 2016. That's what has to be divided up. It's not a country with huge surpluses like Hong Kong is, where they can do this. It's a country where the debt to GDP ratio is going to be about 90%. That is the key issue which makes all of this very difficult, because it's a limit to what you can afford to do.
Okay, but let me come back, being devil's advocate for a moment, because the Scottish Government's position has been that the quid pro quo of not achieving a monetary union would be not taking the share of the debt. So if your argument is that it would immediately have a large amount of debt and that would stop sterlingisation happening, well, what's to stop it working if it doesn't have the large share of debt? Presumably, it's because it wouldn't then immediately be able to start to build up a surplus, because it would still be in day-to-day deficit in its spending. So is that the argument why it can't happen, even if it doesn't take the share of debt and has the poor debt ratio at start-up?
So if the UK... The Bank of England is an institution of the United Kingdom government, which includes, of course, Scotland, Northern Ireland, England and Wales. With Scotland becoming an independent country, it will continue to be an institution of that United Kingdom state. It is therefore backed by the taxpayers of that state. Those taxpayers wouldn't be Scottish taxpayers, so Bank of England blew up. It's not Scotland's problem. It's the rest of the UK's problem. Vice versa, if Scotland blew up, it's not the Bank of England, it is taxpayers' problem, it's Scotland's problem. That's what independence means. It means taking responsibility for what goes on in your country. Now, the idea that, well, we can't have another strategy because of this amount of debt, so therefore we won't pay the debt, which is, I think, what you were alluding to, or somehow we won't take our share of the debt, or...
But that's the Scottish Government's position.
Well, I don't know if there is a clear position, actually. But if the proposal you're suggesting, I think most people would say an independent Scotland would be expected to take a fair share of the existing UK public sector debt. That is what the Scottish Government have said they would do. Now, you get into the question of what is a fair share. Reasonable question.
Well, I accept what you're saying, but you're going off on a little bit of a tangent here, because if what I'm trying to do is set up the position where, you know, you're saying that sterlingisation cannot work because of the debt ratio, and it's not like Hong Kong because they don't have debt and we would have lots of debt. Well, if the position of the Scottish Government, and I accept that it's not a stated, if we don't get this, we're not going to take that. But there have been enough hints towards that, you know, there's a bargaining tool to be used here, that if we don't get a monetary union, then we won't necessarily take the debt. Now, if that came to pass, does that answer your question that, or rather my question that I posed about what you're saying, that would make sterlingisation work, because it would put us closer to a Hong Kong position where we didn't have debt? Or are we still left in a position where, because our spending than our incomes.
I got you, yeah.
Would it still leave us unable to be in that position?
Okay, so if an independent Scotland had no debt, for whatever reason you're going to suggest happens in a negotiation, but if it had no debt, clearly, from one point of view, other options would become more viable, except for two things. One, you'd still, as you quite rightly pointed out, still be running a fiscal deficit, and you're going to have to generate surpluses if you want to perform things like lend of last resort. It's not just about getting to balance. Hong Kong's had surpluses almost uninterrupted for 30 years. That's the first aspect. The second aspect is, you in that process, you are presumably going to be issuing some debt in order to generate a savings pool to be able to provide things like lend of last resort and so on, and if you're running deficits, you're going to have to borrow from somebody where you have pretty publicly not taken what you've considered to be, or other people consider to be, a fair share of debt. So then you have the consequences, one, for the existing deficits, and two, for when you do start to raise debt, what is the price, what is the interest rate you're going to have to pay on that debt, given that you would not, under your scenario, have accepted a fair share of the existing UK debt, and all of the things that people like credit rating agencies will interpret that to be.
Okay, so to sum up, we're very different from Hong Kong because we either accept a share of the debt, therefore cannot act as lender of last resort in the way that they do, or even if we don't have the share of debt, we can't build up the surplus to enable us to act as Hong Kong does.
It would be more difficult for you to build up the surplus. There's not a can't here. If Scotland, an independent Scotland, ran large fiscal surpluses over a sustained period of time, options would certainly become available to it.
But what it would have to do to be able to run those fiscal surpluses would be pretty horrendous.
Well, in short, you have to raise more money than you spend. And there's a number of choices you can make in that. That's obviously for politicians to do. You'd have to do that for a sustained number of years, generate these surpluses in order to do this. That gets made more difficult if you don't take on any debt at the beginning, because the interest rate that you would pay to service whatever debt obligations you'd have would be greater. But certainly running fiscal surpluses for a number of years, substantial fiscal surpluses for a number of years, Scotland would have a fiscal a surplus, it would have fiscal reserves, it would be judged by domestic, by Scottish citizens and foreign citizens as a country which can have a credible macroeconomic adjustment. That is quite a tall ask, but one that, you know, Scotland would make its own decision, so one that it can deliver.
Final question, for a number of years, what are we talking about?
Well, so...
How do you build up that credibility?
So, if you were to have a domestic banking system, by which I mean legally based and regulated in Scotland, where Scotland would provide the deposit insurance, so how many deposits are there in Scotland, and what proportion of that would you perhaps have to think about building up this sort of reserve? These are the sort of numbers. We're talking substantial numbers if you were to have the sort of reserves to provide your own lend of last resort operation using fiscal accounts.
I think Professor Bell is anxious to give me a number.
Taking Angus's number of a 30% ratio of fiscal a fund relative to GDP that you might support lender of last resort and other activities with, we're currently around an 8% deficit. Over 4 years, if the current government programme is successful in reducing the deficit, we'll get to about just about a fiscal balance. So then you've got to think about how many years and what kind of annual surplus you would need to do. Obviously, if you think 6 years, well, that means a 5% surplus each year. So a 5% excess of taxation revenue over spending.
Okay.
Could I just add a little point there, which follows up what Angus said? Angus said that if you build up these surpluses, it would be possible to deal with the oil volatility effect. That may be true, I think, in part. But, of course, the oil volatility effect comes in, as I said earlier, on day one of independence. Uh-huh. So even if you could do that, it's going to take a long time to build up the kind of reserves that, for example, Norway has built up to do exactly that. So even if you were to engage in an austerity programme, the regime is still a dead duck, as far as I can see. Yeah.
Well, that's right. I mean, the operation in the long term might be a success, but in the short term, the patients died.
Exactly. Yeah.
I mean, there seems to be, you know, an element. Can I just clarify a couple of points, if I could? It's been mentioned on several occasions by the Scottish Government that they would refuse to accept any share of the debt if they didn't get their way in a shared currency. And I think that's quite clearly been trailed as a policy option. What I'm not clear about is what the consequences in interest rate terms would be for real people. I mean, I understand, Mr. Armstrong's point about there would be an increase in the interest rates. I know that we seem to have a variety of hallelujahs outside. I'm not sure it relates to this particular point I'm making, but I understand that there would be an increase in the interest rates for government borrowing, for a separate Scotland. I am not clear what that would mean for real people in terms of mortgages and so on. Would there be a complete disconnect so that mortgages would carry on as they are at the moment, irrespective of the rate at which the Scottish Government borrows? Or would the mortgage of people in my constituency be directly related to the increase in the borrowing rate that's been applied to Scottish Government debt? Maybe yourself first, and then I'll pick up the others.
Sure. So mortgage rates depend on the official interest rate plus the risk to the bank of it raising its own funds. So the riskiness of banks matter to people's mortgage rates, which is why in the crisis a lot of the mortgage products disappeared and some of the mortgage rates that people paid in the early days of the crisis actually went up, even though official rates were very low. So the risk that banks pay matters. Now, what determines the risk of banks? Well, if they are Scottish banks, by which I mean either incorporated in Scotland or subsidiaries in Scotland, so they are legally Scottish institutions, then they will be independently capitalised, and their credit standing will depend in part on the soundness of the business, but also in part on the soundness of the institution which stands behind them. And the institution that will be standing behind these subsidiaries and Scottish incorporated banks is called the Scottish Government. In fact, this has been made very clear by rating agencies. Rating agencies judge banks on two bases now. One is the soundness of the bank, and two is the soundness of the government, which actually would be its backstop. So they explicitly say, we take this into consideration. If these mortgage products were provided by Scottish subsidiaries, Scottish incorporated banks, then that suggests that the ratings of these institutions would not be as good as they would be as part of the United Kingdom, which suggests that the cost of funding would be higher, which would have a knock-on effect for the cost of borrowing. So if they're Scottish incorporated and subsidiaries in Scotland, then the sort of scenario you're painting would lead to a higher cost of capital for these institutions, for these banks, and therefore higher borrowing costs. If, however, the mortgages were provided by branches of rest of UK banks, so these are banks located in the rest of the United Kingdom, selling mortgages into an independent Scotland, then it would depend on the funding cost of the UK bank. And the UK bank funding cost, presumably, would be relatively unchanged. On that basis, the mortgage rates might not go up for those sort of mortgage products. And so you can quite easily see there's a competition issue here of which one would win. You see, so this is why it matters where the location of business is.
Well, presumably in those circumstances, nobody in their right mind then would willingly have their mortgage with either a Scottish institution or a Scottish subsidiary. They would all want to make sure that their mortgages were with branches of UK institutions. My constituents should now be going off and just checking what their mortgage arrangements are.
So the the way that Scottish institutions would respond, presumably, would be by becoming much safer and sounder than the rest of the UK ones. So when a rating agency looked at it, they would say, well, okay, the government behind you may have not taken its fair share of the debt, but you are so safe and sound, this is never going to be an issue. And so one of the odd things you tend to see is that in countries which have dollarized, their banks actually tend to hold very high levels of reserves because they know fine well there's no government there.
Yes, but I mean, while I understand the point about Scotland possibly becoming the El Salvador of Europe, being destabilizing, but if the banks wanted to hold bigger capital surpluses, this is not something that can be done overnight.
No.
So, you know, on day one of a separate Scotland, these capital balances will not have been built up, and therefore the impact presumably on mortgage rates for my constituents who are holding mortgages from Scottish institutions or subsidiaries in Scotland will rocket upwards, whereas hopefully those who have the mortgages with branches of UK institutions will remain the same. Does that seem accurate?
Well, your constituents, depending on who they bank with, so Scottish banking is dominated by Lloyds Bank Group or HBOS and RBS, quite clearly. It depends where they would be located post-independence. This gets us back to the discussion at the beginning. You see, now it does matter where you're located.
Right. Can I just clarify then what, I mean, I was going to, that was the second area. So, okay, I understand that. But as well as then Professor McDonald's recommendation that people move their money, they should also be considering moving their mortgage. But since, you know, transferring your mortgage from one institution to another tends by and large to take a certain amount of time, and in these difficult times it's becoming tighter and tighter. But it's the sensible thing for people to do now would be to check who's holding their mortgage and to consider getting it transferred right away.
Yeah, but I think the point I would make there is that there's obviously going to be a distinction between assets and liabilities. And what I'm thinking of there is that if you do move to a separate currency, I would imagine that currency is going to depreciate relative to sterling, the remaining UK's currency. And therefore, if it's liabilities you've got denominated in the rest of the UK, which would be your mortgage, if you have to pay off the principal, for example, which is still denominated in sterling, then that could, of course, be equally bad news for someone who had switched their mortgage from it. Yeah, so
yes,
you've got to, yeah.
I've actually got in my list of questions for separate currency, the question of mortgages as well.
Fair enough.
So, I mean, to some extent, people, you know, if you work on the basis that the Scottish Government is saying that they will continue to use sterling, and if we assume at the moment, I mean, which I think is the absolutely correct assumption to make, that there will be no currency union, we are then going to have this sterlingisation. And in these circumstances, not only is it sensible for people to move their deposits, they should also move their liabilities as well in the form of mortgages, since that by that they've got a higher chance of keeping a reasonable mortgage rate. Now, is that correct? I can see some noddings, but unfortunately Hansard doesn't record noddings. So I think we would have to have some sort of statement from yourselves. I mean, Mr. Armstrong and then Mr. Kelly, maybe.
Sure. Well, I'll just keep my comments short. The domicile and the structure of the bank that is provided your deposit savings account or your mortgages will now matter, and this is why the location of banks will start to matter, because it will depend on the regulator and it will depend on the sovereign that stands behind those institutions.
I only want to add one observation, as I say, drawing on the analysis that's been done by our industry. There is a clear consensus that if there is a yes vote, there will be a relatively modest impact on sterling, although I appreciate there are other views that it might be larger. But in terms of the ratings, there is a clear consensus that as an independent country, Scotland would have a lower rating than the rest of the UK. If you have a lower rating as a sovereign, I think this linkage still applies even in a sterlingisation situation. That affects the ratings of the companies that are domiciled within that sovereign. So you can't sort of have, for example, I think it's very unusual, I think it can theoretically happen, to have a sort of AAA rated company within a jurisdiction which is relatively, you know, rated lower than that. So the relationship between the overall sovereign rating and the ratings that are available to companies within the jurisdiction could also be a factor.
Right, fine. Ian.
I think taking all of that into account, there is also the question of the durability of a sterlingised area. What happens if it does not endure? And it may well be that such a state of affairs would not endure in the medium to long term. That would be even worse because there are businesses there. This is horribly complex as it is, and our members tell us that, how uncertain and complex all of this is. But if that state of affairs was to break down, then we could see a situation where companies' assets are here, their liabilities are over there, their earnings could be in pounds sterling, but their costs go into what replaces a sterlingised pound in Scotland, and so on and so forth. And that would be a matter of very considerable seriousness for business.
Can I just clarify? I mean, am I right in thinking that there is a discrepancy between what Professor MacDonald was saying and yourself? Because when you seem to be saying that this would not be stable over the medium to long term, but I thought that Professor MacDonald was saying that there was a real danger that the markets would speculate against sterlingisation in such a way as to bring about change really quite rapidly, and that it would descend into chaos and force some other changes within a much shorter timescale than Mr. McMillan seemed to be suggesting.
Well, that's what I believe, coming at this from a currency aspect. That's what all the evidence seems to suggest, that if financial markets are either going to make a capital gain or a capital loss, they're not going to wait till the medium term to incur that loss or gain. They're going to bring the medium term back to the present because they want that gain now. And that's the whole point of the so-called speculative attack literature, where currencies are attacked because they're not able to address underlying competitiveness. And I think we saw a classic example of that, I think it was last week, where Argentina, which defaulted 13 years ago on its debt, because it was defending an inappropriate exchange rate, its competitiveness was changing, and it defaulted in its debt, and it's still not been back in corporate bond markets. It's had to default again, as we've seen, and it led to an economic collapse in the country with 100% inflation shortly after that default.
Could you just clarify what a speculative attack means? I mean, visions of sort of Swiss gnomes, with bags of swag. I mean, I'm not quite sure how it actually operates.
Yeah, well, it can operate in a number of ways, but it's basically a recognition by the market that a country's exchange rate, its chosen exchange rate, which here would be, I think we've accepted, would be 1-to-1, is not appropriate. Now, in some cases, it may take some time for all these gnomes to network, but often what happens is there's a big gnome, and in the UK's experience, that was George Soros. He effectively coordinated speculators. He said, I don't believe Sterling's rate within the ERM is tenable, and he said, I'm going to hit the Bank of England, and that's what he did. But by doing that and by saying that, by making that commitment, he coordinated all the gnomes, if you like. And so there was huge pressure, which
I understand that. Yeah. I understand the concept of selling sterling short.
Okay.
I understand that. What I'm not clear about is how that operates in circumstances where both countries have got sterling, as it were, where the UK has got sterling and Scotland is sterlingised. So, I mean, what is it you sell short?
So, when you both have the same currency, as an independent country, you always have the option to introduce another currency. So the issue we're talking about here is capital flight. If people, and I'm not saying whether they would or not, but if people thought that this arrangement was not credible, then they would move their money out of one country into a different jurisdiction, and that capital flight would lead to a lower and lower level of economic activity until such point, and a worsening fiscal accounts, until at such point people democratically decide this is not worth it anymore, which is essentially what happened in Argentina in the currency board collapse. So they had a legal currency board that collapsed in 2001.
Yeah.
2001, where a number of controls and restrictions had been put in place. It basically led to riots in the street and so on. Now, what's interesting here is that we know from the white paper that there is an opportunity to change currency arrangements at some point in the future. And if enough pain has been imposed, will people take that opportunity? Because if they do, then you'd be introducing a different regime in difficult circumstances, and that's where you can get potential gains or losses. So that's how you do an attack then. The other way you would do an attack with one currency is the same way as they did it in the Eurozone. You don't have to have a currency to form an attack. You can do it through interest rates. These countries, all of a sudden, the governments, they couldn't issue bonds or raise finance at a reasonable price. And so the attack mutates into an interest rate issue when, because your economic activity is low, so you have to issue bonds to pay for your fiscal deficits. But when you go to issue bonds, people say, we don't think you can pay us back, so we're going to charge you a higher interest rate. That higher interest rate becomes, well, then my fiscal deficit is going to be worse, which means I'm going to have to issue more bonds, which means I'm definitely going to charge you a higher interest rate. And around it goes, and that's another way the fiscal attack can happen. So just having, say, one currency, therefore we can't have an attack, that's not the case. It is the flows of private citizens, both businesses and households, which will decide the durability of the exchange rate, not what any government decides to put in place.
And the attack, before I come in, I mean, the attack in that way, the actions of private citizens and corporations are not necessarily designed to attack the currency. They're just people taking prudent decisions to move their money to safer jurisdictions. But the effect is the same as in an attack.
That's correct. So people, the nature of human beings, we've seen throughout centuries, is they look to preserve their capital.
Fine. David.
Loans are not necessarily malign. They are just acting in their own interests. And the other case where you had a single currency, where this happened recently, of course, was the Czech and Slovak Republic example, where effectively it was capital flight that caused the eventual breakup of the currency there.
Right. Thanks.
I just thought it'd be useful to quote from the UBS Global Research on this, and they say, events in every monetary union breakup of the 20th century have shown that bank depositors preempt any political negotiations and withdraw money, leading to the incentive to reduce credit creation and to raise interest rates for domicile businesses. So I think their view is that all of this is driven, as others are rightly saying, I think, by customer sentiment and people's actions rather than, you know, I suppose, theories about currency unions or other things.
Well, I think we've covered sterlingisation fairly thoroughly, but possibly we'll come back to it if other questions occur to us. Maybe I could turn now to Graham to pick up issues relating to the euro. Graham.
Yes, thanks very much, Chair. Visions of gnomes going about the place, along with the angels singing outside. Okay, so we've kind of established that in terms of there being a formal currency union post-independence, that's not a realistic option. Neither is sterlingisation, or else Scotland and an independent scenario would probably be an economic basket case. And of course, in terms of a plan B, there's nothing in the white paper to suggest that the government, the Scottish government, have given that any serious due consideration, although we know that there are some people in the Yes camp who actually do take the view there should be a separate, distinct currency post-independence. In terms of the euro, now we obviously are aware that the ambition of an independent Scotland would be to join the European Union, and certainly would have to give a commitment, at least in the long term, to join the euro. And we're aware that there are implications if Scotland was to go down that path. I think initially Professor Bell suggested that it's an idea that's probably already been written off. But I just wanted to explore whether you thought that Scotland, an independent Scotland, being in the Eurozone would be a good thing for Scotland. Ian, would you like to kick off?
Thank you very much. Well, I think the first thing is that were Scotland to make a bid to join the Euro, then presumably it would have to be a member of the European Union first. And, you know, again, you know, our members have seen considerable difficulties arising because the UK government, and with some academic support, and indeed the public statements of the President of the European Council and the President of the European Commission, has said that an independent Scotland would be a new state outside the treaties. The rest of the UK would be the continuing state, with the treaties still applying. And therefore, an independent Scotland would need to apply and go through the negotiation process. And you know, if eventually it was admitted to the European Union by all 28 member states, the conditions of membership could be different. Now, of course, that's controversial because the Scottish government say that that would not happen, and they have some academic support to suggest that that Scotland's passage into the EU or continuing in the EU would be more straightforward, albeit with some conditions which may differ from those that exist at the moment. So that's the first complexity in all of this, is that you know, it could take time for Scotland to take or in some way maintain its place in the EU, with the euro coming, you know, some time after that. So what happens in the intervening period? You know, after secession, what currency would be used, what arrangements would be put in place there, and for our members, that's a matter of concern. But even with the euro, we've seen what happens in a currency zone where political union and fiscal union are absent, and indeed, Dr. Armstrong described the attack on some of the countries through fiscal levers and so on. But there's also the question of long-term trading arrangements, because Scotland's entry to the euro would mean that it would be using a different currency from that in the rest of the UK. The rest of the UK, it's our closest neighbour, it's our largest trading partner, with nearly 70% of our exports going to the rest of the UK. And therefore, entry into the Eurozone would introduce two things. First, exchange rate differences, and therefore costs around that. And it would also introduce costs of exchange, so that when companies buy sterling, by trading their euros, there's a cost to pay for that. There's also a spread and so on. So again, this, not only are there uncertainties around all of this, but there's actually scope for an increase in cost of doing business across that international border, as it would become and compounded by a different currency.
Okay, well, that's interesting. I mean, in terms of your members, I mean, is this the kind of thing that your members are saying to you, that if we ended up in that kind of scenario, that there would be a real serious concern because of the barriers in terms of trading, obviously, you know, with regards to south of the border, and increased costs when it comes to the whole issue of exchange rates?
That's correct. That's the concern. And also all the short to medium term uncertainty that surrounds that as we go forward in the event of a yes vote.
Okay, thanks. If we maybe could look at the implications of Scotland post-independence, you know, being part of the euro, and the implications in terms of Scotland's fiscal policy. Could maybe describe what kind of scenario would we see in a situation like that, and would that be, you know, advantageous to an independent Scotland or disadvantageous? Anybody want to pick up on that point?
So, we know that in the past there were the Stability and Growth Pact, which spectacularly, I think it's fair to say, failed because of the bigger countries, and they have been replaced by what's being called the Fiscal Compact, which, because there's not actually political union between all of these countries, they're kind of doing it slightly in the backdoor way by saying, in this Fiscal Compact, you have to legislate to have balanced budgets. Now, there is some wiggle room for when you have difficult periods, so it's not all periods. But so there, if an independent Scotland were to join the euro, then it would also be signing into these fiscal constraints, which, you know, yes. may be perfectly sensible, but there would be fiscal constraints they'd be signing into.
And presumably there'd be an impact on the cost of borrowing as well, probably in the wrong direction.
Well, if they joined the euro, then they would be using the euro. Now, the interest rates, as we know, are not identical in each country in the eurozone. It would be very nice if they were, but they're not. And the interest rates would depend on the position that Scotland would take. It would depend on the debt that it would inherit, depend on its productivity, its economic policies, all a number of things. So it would depend on what Scotland would look like within the euro. I have to say that I am less sceptical than some on an independent Scotland using the euro. There will be a number of advantages to it as well. Scotland has a big financial sector, as we've talked about. It will be able to spread some of those risks within within the euro community. So there are advantages as well. It would have a say on the ECB Council. It would have a say of a monetary policy. Okay, it would be one of 20 voices, but it would be a voice. I think that it's too easy to dismiss it because of its last 10 years of troubles, or 8 years of troubles. I think it's too easy to dismiss it out of hand without actually considering what the pros and cons are here. Transitional arrangements, absolutely. Currency volatility, vis-a-vis your biggest country, completely agree. I think that some of those issues about currency volatility vis-a-vis your biggest country, it didn't cause a disaster for those European countries that have not joined the euro. It didn't cause their exports to collapse. I just not quite as worried as some.
Can I just add something there? It goes back, I'm afraid, to the oil effect, the petrol effect. That's still there, whether you join the euro or not. And of course, the reason that Norway hasn't joined the euro is because of the oil effect. And it would have an independent Scotland would have a similar amount of oil if it got a geographic share to the Norwegian case, both in terms of its trade and as a proportion of GDP. All of the existing EU members are non-oil producers, so you would have this important asymmetric competitiveness effect. How do you deal with that? You may have to not just have a budget balance, but you may have to have a budgetary surplus over a number of years. And so I think it suffers from the same problems that any fixed rate regime suffers for an independent Scotland.
Can I just clarify, when you say asymmetric competitive effect, what's that in real words that the ordinary people would understand?
Right, well, basically if you have an increase in the price of oil, say a dramatic increase as we've seen at times when there's been war in the Middle East or whatever, then there's a big spike in the price of oil. So a producer of oil gets a huge hit, if you like, in their inflation, loosely speaking. So their inflation rate goes up, but the converse should be happening in countries which are oil importers, by and large.
And what is then the effect of that on industry in Scotland and on real people?
Well, that then has knock-on effects to your non-oil sector. This is the crucial thing, because Scotland and, of course, the euro area have a well-diversified non-oil sector. So if you're what we call the real exchange rate, or your competitiveness is moving around a lot with oil prices, as it would be in Scotland, that has knock-on effects for your non-oil sector. I mean, if you imagine the price goes up in the oil sector, therefore the basic mechanism is that wages will go up, material inputs will be driven up in that sector, and there are channels which push that into the non-oil sector. And so it becomes uncompetitive, and you essentially see the non-oil sector being squeezed out. And that's a very real issue in Scotland, because of course the non-oil trade position is one of a very significant deficit. And so that would make that situation worse. And if it's not addressed by means of flexibility in your exchange rate, you'll ultimately get to a situation where you won't have much of a non-oil sector, because it will have been crowded out, as we say, by the oil sector.
Fine, thanks.
What would be the situation, if Scotland applied to join the EU or was in the EU, and obviously, as we said earlier, has to give that long-term commitment to join the euro. What would happen if, and it's the point that Mike Crockett raised early in terms of, the S&P have said that if they're not going to have a formal currency union with the rest of the UK post-independence, it's going to renege on accepting its fair share of the national debt. Now, if that was the case, then surely Scotland, independent Scotland, would be seen as a greater risk to the international money lenders, and therefore that would, I presume, would impact negatively on borrowing. But in terms of negotiations to join the euro at the end of the day, the powers that be, would they not see that kind of greater risk scenario being a problem for an independent Scotland ultimately joining the euro? And I think Owen wants to come in on that point.
I think it's really, because you're moving to a sort of general point about the process of joining the EU and the relationship between that process and the eurozone. It is, I think, pretty much a basic requirement for joining the EU that all international disputes or disagreements with other member states for absolutely certain, but in general, are sorted out beforehand. So there would, I think, and I say this not on the basis of particularly talking to either side of the debate here, but making, you know, really trying to talk to other decision makers in this process, so in other member states and in the institutions in Brussels, I think that is a really basic requirement. So the timing of all of this matters. If you are continuing to have some kind of dispute about the debt or something like that, that will be a problem. And it will also obviously make it more difficult for the UK, the rest of the UK, to play the leading role that it will need to play in terms of securing Scotland's accession process or negotiation process, depending on what you think about how that process will be followed. On financial services industry in particular, if you were in the Eurozone, you would also be joining the sort of caravan that is currently moving a bit sporadically, but nonetheless is a big and really important caravan towards European Banking Union. So it would have implications for the banking industry for sure, and the financial services industry in general. There is a lot of talk at the moment about the banking union going further. There's ECB board members have given speeches about European capital markets and other things. So it would also have an impact, assuming, as it will, I think, the rest of the UK remains, you know, with an opt-out, as it obviously will. There's no suggestion that the rest of the UK would join the euro.
Yeah.
You would then, it would be quite a fundamental change in the nature of the regulatory unit within which the Scottish industry sat.
Anybody else want to pick up on
that? Yeah, so your point about EU entry, so I think to sort of shortcut long stories, there's going to be a political negotiation in terms of entry. However, the political negotiation is predicated on the fact that the UK is supporting it. Now, if Scotland, if taking the scenario that Mike painted, said we are not taking a fair share of our debt, well, that debt doesn't disappear.
No.
The rest of the UK then have a bigger debt burden per person. And, you know, one would have to think whether that would be okay with the rest of the UK, which is presumably part of the negotiation. And I assume there's other countries in Europe that would also like to walk away from their fair share of the debt as well. Quite, you know, there's a lot of debt around these days. I think it'd be brave to assume this would have no impact at all on those political discussions. But they are political discussions, and we haven't been in this situation before, so it's... hypothesising, really.
Well, I think we've covered a lot of stuff relating to the Scotland's access to or entry into the EU in other
yes,
events,
yes,
and I think
yes.
It's helpful to have it touched on here, just to, you know, make the point that all these things interrelate. Is that you?
Yeah.
Can I just pick up one point relating to the previous discussions that we had about sterlingisation and its potential collapse? I mean, is it possible to foresee or likely to foresee a situation where sterlingisation is tried and collapses, and then is a flight into the euro then a logical path to take, or in these circumstances is it even less credible to go for the euro than you would if you were starting from scratch?
Well, I would say yes, it is less credible because of the oil effect. If it wasn't for the oil effect, then I think things would be very different. But because of the oil effect, I think the only feasible option for an independent Scotland would be to have a separate currency, which, you know, raises a number of other issues. But I don't see collapse of sterling and then try the eurozone as being successful for the reasons I gave earlier. Yeah. That you're going to really hit your non-oil export sector unless you can build up very significant fiscal surplus.
Is that a general view, fiscal?
Just that maybe I'm less optimistic about the longevity of the oil industry than Ronnie is. I mean, if we are in a situation where the amount of oil production has been falling very, very consistently over the years. There's still a lot out there, but it's becoming increasingly costly to get it out. So there is, I think, a question of balance here. How much will oil be affecting the Scottish competitiveness 10, 15 years from now?
Could I just clarify, though? I mean, the issues that would be faced by Scotland are not 10, 15 years
no,
from
no,
now.
No,
I mean,
no,
these,
no.
The oil effect that Professor MacDonald was referring to would be impacting on the decisions that were taken pretty much in the short term. And unless I'm mistaken, the consensus was that sterlingisation wouldn't last that long, and therefore Scotland would be in a separate Scotland, be in a position of having to make a choice about what to do, possibly join the euro, you know, in a relatively short period, and the fact that oil's running out wouldn't even come into it.
Well, I think it wouldn't have an immediate option to join the euro. I mean, it depends what length of time we're talking about. If we're talking matters months in relation to sterlingisation, there's no option but to go for your own currency, it seems to me. And then at some subsequent time in the future, which it probably would be the long-term future, think about other options.
Right. Sorry, Ian.
Well, I was just going to add, sorry. I'm still showing, there we are. I was just going to add to that, Chairman, that I share David Bell's view that the euro may not be an option in early days because there would be conditions attached to an independent Scotland's entry there. I mean, it would be a very difficult situation because, you know, from what we've heard today, the conditions that need to exist to support a sterlingisation are absent. In terms of the state of the annual public finances in Scotland, the reserves and the ability to build reserves to support such a regime just are not there. I can't help you today with what would be the least worst alternative. We haven't looked at this in detail in the CBI. We don't have a member mandate, but each of these options, we haven't ranked them as least desirable, but they all are undesirable.
Sorry, may I just, so I just want to clarify our position here. To join the euro, first of all, there's a process, which I said joining the European Union is a political negotiation. To join the euro is a different thing. You know, you can be a member of the European Union and not be part of the euro. That's what the UK has. To join the euro, you have to enter what's called ERM2, first of all, which requires you to keep your currency stable for 2 years. So you have this difficult intermediate period where the rules suggest, and every country has had to do this that's gone into the euro, where you'd have your own currency, because you couldn't guarantee you could keep sterling stable. That would depend on this other country called the rest of the UK. So you have this awkward intermediate period where you'd have to have your own currency if you just stick by that process. Can I also just say that, none of us, the world economy may go on to a massive boom for the next 10 years. None of us actually know, have a crystal ball on any of these things. All we can look at is the risks and exposures that are being created without saying exactly what parts might be. The world economy might be absolutely, you know, booming like we've never seen it before in the next 10 years. So I think that the portrayal, speaking for myself, that, you know, this would necessarily, on all circumstances, lead to a collapse. That's not what I'm trying to say. What I'm trying to say is that there are risks, serious risks, around this exchange rate regime.
Right. Okay, Mike, do you want to pick up then the issues about own currency?
All right. We've dealt with Plan A, which was monetary union, as having been ruled out by the rest of the UK. But if Plan B was sterlingisation, we've pretty much said that would collapse pretty quickly. Plan C, which is the euro, isn't a short-term option, and there are difficulties around the process of how you would get there. So we're left with Plan D, which is the separate Scottish currency. Now, there are many on both sides of the debate that are actually saying that this should have been Plan A all along, because it's potentially the best solution for Scotland, giving control over financial economic levers. I mean, is that the situation? Is a separate Scottish currency actually best for an independent Scotland? Ian.
Somebody's got their mic on. Well, as I say, we have not ranked these in terms of least worst, but I think we need to look at the characteristics of what a separate Scottish currency would have. As you rightly say, Mike, you know, the currency, if it was floating, you know, could move around, you know, in a way that could take economic shocks and strains. That would not be able to happen if it were tied to another currency. But then it introduces other problems. So, for example, I mentioned that the entry to the euro would cause exchange rate costs and risks between Scotland and the rest of the United Kingdom, Scotland's largest trading partner. Problem with a currency, Scotland having its own currency, is that it would introduce these costs and risks to every other country in the world, including the European Union and the Eurozone. So, you know, that for our members, again, you know, is not a good option. Costs would be introduced to their operations and doing business that don't exist at the moment. And when you compound that with, over time, different regulation that Owen's talked about, different laws, rules, taxes, and so on, the fear of our members is that the barriers to doing business across the United Kingdom and into other jurisdictions, you know, goes up and not down or not stable. So again, on that particular one, it's not an attractive option for our members.
Well, I'm interested that you're saying, you know, you're trying to identify the least worst option, because the arguments that we've already heard earlier on, Professor McDonald was making this point that if you have effectively a petrol currency, then the dangers to the rest of the Scottish economy must be quite large, and therefore having your own currency may be the best way of isolating yourselves from, or protecting yourselves from that sort of danger. I mean, is that?
I think that's a very fair point, and I suppose the point I'm making is that, you know, we haven't done detailed work in the CBI to be able to rank these other unpalatable options into least palatable. And therefore, I don't have a member mandate to come here today and tell you that, well, you know, if we can't keep the pound sterling in a United Kingdom, then, you know, our preferred and least worst option is X. I don't have a mandate to do that. But what I can explore with you, you know, are the costs and the risks and the characteristics of the options that you're looking at. And I hope that's helpful.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, Professor McDonald, you don't have a member mandate. You don't need a member mandate. What is it? What's the issue, you know, with a separate Scottish currency? Is that best for actually the rest of Scottish business?
It would be in the long term. But my concern is the transition to the medium to longer term. And I say that because if you're going to have a separate currency which addresses the oil issue, the effect oil will have in your non-oil sector, it needs to be a managed currency. It needs to be what we call a managed float. Now, as Angus said earlier, that if you were to take the share of foreign exchange reserves that an independent Scotland would be likely to get, it's between £6 and £7 billion. Now, that's been described, I think it was John Kay who so aptly described it, as a handful of loose change for hedge funds. What that means effectively is that you couldn't have a fixed or managed exchange rate to start with. That these reserves are not sufficient to support a fixed exchange rate. So you're going to have a flexible exchange rate, as Ian McMillan said. And the key point about flexible exchange rates is they're very volatile. And I believe they'd be especially volatile with a newly minted country as Scotland would be, where it would be facing, we believe, quite significant fiscal deficits. It would be facing the kind of debt issues that Angus mentioned. So I believe the currency would be very volatile, and it would have deleterious effects on trade, with the, particularly obviously with the rest of the UK, our main trading partner. Now, moving forward, to get to a position where you could have a managed currency which would address the issues that you're going to have to face in independent Scotland, namely this petrol currency issue, you're going to have to do what was argued earlier. You're going to have to build up foreign exchange reserves, significant foreign exchange reserves, along, I would think, the example of Hong Kong. To do that, you're going to have to run fiscal surpluses. There's no question about that. Now, the figure that we're running with at the moment for an independent Scotland in 2016 is between 5 and 7% for the fiscal deficit. So if you're going to have your own currency and you're going to move towards managing that currency properly, you're going to have to turn that deficit around and move it into a surplus to accumulate foreign exchange reserves. Now, clearly, that's going to be a very, very painful process. But that essentially is what you're going to have to do. There is no other alternative option for currency other than to have your own currency, given the oil effect. But if you do that, then you're going to have this quite long, protracted period of austerity, I believe. Okay. Yeah.
Could you or another member of the panel just explain why there is a difficulty at start-up of a new currency in pegging it to sterling or the euro or the dollar or any other currency you wanted to choose?
Well, that's effectively to say you're going to fix the exchange rate. And to fix an exchange rate, you've got to give an unlimited commitment to the markets that you're going to defend the rate you've chosen. That's the commitment. To give an unlimited commitment, you've got to have massive foreign exchange reserves.
Because you would have to be buying
The foreign exactly.
exchange to defend your position.
And the only way, and this is a point I didn't make, but I think it's an important one, the only way that you could attenuate the volatility in the short term until you built up your foreign exchange reserves would be by putting up your interest rate relative to your trading partners. So interest rates would be higher than your trading partners with all the repercussions that would have for loans and mortgages and so on in the economy.
In order to attract...
You've got to stabilise the currency, and one of the key ways you can do that is through interest rates. That is one of the main drivers of exchange rates.
Okay. I wonder if I just let Lindsay, do you want to come in on that particular point?
Yes. This is working properly. Realistically, how long would it take to establish a new currency in a central bank?
The actual...
What would happen in the interim?
Is that something you've looked at? The time frame?
Realistically, I think it could be done in 3 to 4 years. So people have done this before, but they've never done it with... The difficulty is the sophistication of the financial institutions.
Yeah.
So what would be required is a whole new set of institutions for an independent Scotland. Okay, that's doable. People have done this before. That's perfectly reasonable. That's fine. The difficulty is to redenominate the contract. So your mortgage, assuming you have one, at the moment is in sterling. I'm not sure whether it's under Scottish or English law, depends where you have it and so on and so forth. But these, since you're going to introduce a new currency, you will have to redenominate the contracts. Now, again, that's a process that's been done. People have introduced their own currency. It's just here you've got very big financial institutions where you're going to have to look at their balance sheets as well and look at what redenomination will mean for them. So that's the difficulty in the transitional arrangement, that you've got a lot of institutional issues and redenomination costs, which obviously brings in genuine uncertainty because we haven't been down this path before. Then you have the economic adjustment, which, as Ronnie's been saying, in order to allow people, Scottish citizens and foreign investors, to believe that this exchange rate can be maintained, then you have to have confidence that Scotland is going to be able to have a robust balance of payments. And one thing robust balance of payments requires is strong fiscal accounts. You need to have a credible government using credible fiscal policy. And perhaps at the beginning, it's going to have to be particularly cautious, but I agree entirely with Ronnie and David that at the beginning, you'll be You would need to run substantial fiscal surpluses for quite a number of years in order to build up those reserves for the rainy days to be able to defend yourself and to be credible with your own citizens that actually there is enough reserves to pay for things like deposit insurance. So you have the economic adjustment, you have the institutional requirements, and you have the legal issues such as redenomination. Those first two, the redenomination institutions, my guess is you could do it in between 2 and 4 years. It'd be difficult, but it's been done before.
4 years would be 2 years into independence.
Well, you know,
I
think here, this is where we get into the issue of, you know, it would be in the rest of the UK's interest to make this as smooth an adjustment as possible. Mm. If people of Scotland decide they want to have independence and they want to have their own currency and there's a reasonable division of assets and liabilities, then that's entirely their own right. Yeah. And why would the UK not be as cooperative as possible in trying to bring that about a stable and secure means as possible? It will be in the rest of the UK's interests.
But can I just clarify
though,
that
sterilisation
couldn't be done. Sorry, can I just clarify that couldn't be done though within the 18-month timetable that the Scottish Government has set for independence?
I think given where we are starting from today, to do all of those changes in a I think it'll be difficult on that timetable to bring about all of those changes of introducing your own currency and do all the redenomination and create the institutional framework. I think that'd be difficult in that time frame.
So that's a bluff then? Well, it's a combination of bluff and bluster, really, isn't it?
Well, I think it's an issue of what aspects could be taken over between two independent countries and still worked on, still parts of the process. Some functions can be shared. For example, over the interim time period, there would be ways of working this through. It is difficult, but it's certainly possible, and it's been done before. And I think it would be erroneous to say that this is just not possible. It is possible. There are clearly risks. This would be a very big job, but it's possible.
Yeah, you say it's in their interest. What would be the interim arrangements in terms of moving from a currency union to a separate currency? Would it be sterilisation?
I don't think there. So there's a presumption there has to be an interim arrangement. There would have to be an agreement for how you do the redenomination. The institutional arrangements, they can be shared for a period of time. You know, neighbours can share things. There are enough skilled people in the Bank of England, the Debt Management Office, and so on. You know, you can have that. That's possible.
When you say share things, like what?
Well, you'd need to build up a number of institutions. You'd have to have a debt management office, you'd have to have a central bank, you'd have to have a tax collection office, you would have to have your own treasury, you would have to have, presumably, your own currency printing mint somewhere, presumably that would be by a central bank, as it often is, and you'd license it out to somebody. So you'd have to create, you know, that's five off the top of my head, you'd have to create these institutions. Now, since these institutions already exist in the United Kingdom, I think it would be reasonable to expect it would be in everybody's interest to be as cooperative as possible, because it is completely in people's democratic right to wish to go this way, to have their own currency. That's completely reasonable for people to cooperate, to have that institutional framework. It's actually what happened in Ireland. There was a lot of cooperation, despite the very much more difficult circumstances that they were going through with the creation of the Irish Free State and the obvious political tensions that were there at the time. So I think those institutional arrangements could be cooperated. But that's a very we're dealing in the issue here of Scotland creating its own currency. And I agree with Ronnie when he said that over the longer term, this is the most credible option. And I, you know, it's interesting that other European countries of similar size to Scotland, Switzerland, Norway, Sweden, Denmark, guess what? They have their own currencies and they don't die. It is possible. It gives you the most economic independence. And what you do with that independence is the responsibility of an independent country. That's what happens.
Yeah, I'm not doubting their ability to establish their own currency. What I'm interested in is the transition arrangements.
Yeah, no, I understand. The transition arrangements is extremely difficult. The legal ones are difficult.
Any other comments?
Yeah.
Over that 3-4 year period.
Yes, I mean, to be fair, the yes side is divided on this. I mean, I think we've got the Greens, the Scottish Socialists, Dennis Canavan, all arguing that the logic is for a for a separate Scottish currency. But that's not what's on offer, as I understand it. I mean, the Yes campaign's position officially in the SNP and the Scottish Government's position is that it would be a shared currency, which I think we've identified is not on the table. But Owen, you wanted to come in on this.
Only just on the specific point of the transition, the UBS Global Research say that sterlingisation would be the transitional arrangement. I mean, they make that point. Since Scotland won't have time to create a new currency, whereas the currency separation, as we've already discussed, will be driven by customer preference. We actually advised our members several months ago that in their contingency planning, a new currency was probably the most likely outcome in the longer term. And since then, as I've mentioned, quite a lot of the analysts within the industry at the high level have come to the same conclusion. So, I mean, in many ways, many of the questions we have been discussing are sort of answered once you posit a new currency, because as Angus has just said, I mean, we kind of know how that works because it happens everywhere. I just wanted briefly as well to add to the list of institutions that Angus was mentioning that would be required. I understand that if you have a new currency, you also need to introduce new clearing and payment systems. And in banking, I think that is a big deal. And I think that does take quite a long time. I don't know how long, but I think it is a really, really big undertaking. And finally, just perhaps going back to the discussion we had earlier on mortgages, one of our members has done quite a lot of work on what happens when you introduce a new currency and then you separate the value of the loan. If it is an existing mortgage loan, it's almost certainly denominated in sterling, and it might be written into the contract if there is a currency bit of the contract. But then obviously the value of your property would then be denominated in the standard security as in the new currency. So you would have to manage the transition between of that process. Now, my understanding, which is very limited, is that when this happened in Eastern Europe recently, where people have been borrowing in euro, and then the forint, for example, sort of really went downhill, I think the government intervened and somehow moved to sort of redenominate mortgages. So either you leave individuals to have that risk of the value of their property being separated from the value of their loan, or you intervene, as I guess one could contemplate, to transfer that currency risk to the banks en masse. But that's something that presumably one would have to look at in the process of introducing a new currency.
Could I just clarify a couple of points about the moving from here to there, as it were? I mean, I think we've already come out and indicated that, in our view, a separate currency for a separate Scotland was the least undesirable of the options. What I'm not clear about is whether or not, given that the Scottish Government has said that they want to be independent in 18 months, whether it is possible to combine that with a longer period before the separate currency is set up, where you have perhaps a shared currency or a currency union for a period, on the understanding that that then means that the Scottish Government can't take a whole number of decisions until such time as the joint currency, or if the single currency, its own currency, is established. Is that feasible as an alternative to leaving the United Kingdom, sterlingisation, and then a separate currency? Or is there another choice about how this can be done? Or does the 18 months have to be abandoned? I mean, it seems to me that there's a number of things being suggested here which are mutually incompatible, and I'm not clear which is the least bad, in a sense, to give up. Yes or no?
Well, I think that, in short, the 18 months period is far too short. I mean, I'm unaware of any country or any two countries or any two units of the sophistication of Scotland and the rest of the UK in terms of their financial integration, their trade integration, separating in the way that is being proposed by the Scottish Government. So there's no precedent for this, really. And I think it would take much, much longer than 18 months just for the physical institutions to be put in place. But I would think that a clean break in terms of currency would be the best way, in the sense that any arrangement that you, if you become independent and then you foist on the country a currency arrangement which isn't appropriate because of all the effects we've mentioned earlier, then, you know, how is that sustainable? I can't see it being sustainable unless you're going to have commitment from, say, the Bank of England to underwrite this transitory currency arrangement. But I can't see our UK taxpayers being too happy about doing that. So I would think you would have to have a longer, you know, a longer transition in terms of the 18-month period to set the whole thing up, but then on day one of independence you do move to the separate currency, but when you do that you've then got another transition, which is the one we were talking about, the economic transition, which is one in which you've got to have higher interest rates and probably an austerity program to build up foreign exchange reserves.
But that would then mean that the Scottish Government would have to decide that it was willing to extend the 18 months. Because if there's a yes vote and the Scottish Government has gone into that referendum saying we will be independent in 18 months, it's not then really for the rest of the UK to say no. The Scottish Government would have to decide that they were going to break their pledge, essentially, and say that we would remain part of the United Kingdom until such time as all these other institutions were established. Now, is that a reasonable summation? I mean, in terms of what we call for, I mean, I think is it appropriate for us to be saying that the Scottish Government have got to clarify whether or not they're going to stick to their 18 months or whether or not they're willing to extend it in order that these other institutions can be established to allow potentially the establishment of a separate currency?
Well, I would strongly say yes, they would have to extend that period for the reasons that we've all been discussing. I think there'd be so much uncertainty in that period, which would be so incredibly damaging to the Scottish economy, and I believe the rest of the UK, that I really do think it would need to be extended. I don't think there's any other way.
Is that a consensus view amongst those of you that feel able to see anything without the danger of being monstered by either your members or the Scottish Government? Ian?
Well, I think that the Scottish Government would need to be prepared to extend the period if they found in practice that the 18-month period just wasn't going to work out because the negotiations were taking longer. But again, the problem is that puts business between a rock and a hard place, because it extends the period of uncertainty from 18 months to whatever the period turns out to be. I come back to this. Of course, the decision is a matter for the people of Scotland, and we'll respect that decision. But I think that the uncertainties and the potential costs involved, are a matter of concern, for our members.
So look, I mean, I'm sure I speak on behalf of a whole raft of people in the political world when I say that business can't go on complaining about uncertainty and, on the other hand, not actually say anything. I mean, if they have these concerns and have a view, then they ought to actually find it within themselves to have the courage of their conviction and say things. I mean, I notice, and I think quite commendably, Babcock has come out recently and said what it believes the impact would be, and agree or disagree, at least they've made it clear what the position. Perhaps you ought to take it back to your members, and indeed, your own members as well, Mr. Kelly, that they ought to be spelling out perhaps a bit more than they've been willing to do up to now what the consequences are of these various options, as well as the general decision overall. So am I right in thinking that we have possibly identified what should be the Scottish Government's plan B in the event that a currency union is not accepted? I mean, that the least bad seems to be the idea of a separate currency but with an extended introduction period. Now, unfortunately, again, nodding doesn't cut it.
Well, yes. So
somebody's going to have to say something.
Well, as you can imagine, I would strongly vote for that. Yeah, definitely.
The others?
I would say that this risk of redenomination exists from day one. And there's a question about how you manage, who bears the costs of that risk. So in other words, everyone will be aware that there is now a possibility of a new currency existing. There's a whole set of institutions to put in place, but that risk will have to be managed throughout this period. And that is going to be an extremely tricky process to avoid the kind of capital flight issues that we've already been discussing. So, I mean, what I'm saying is it's not just as simple as setting up the institutions maybe over a longer time horizon. There is this risk that has to be managed.
Well, presumably that raises then one of the issues that we were going to come back to, which is the question of lender or last resort, or who ultimately stands behind this whole process. But presumably the UK government and the Bank of England, if there were circumstances where it was agreed that we were moving towards a separate currency, with, you know, general goodwill and so on and so forth, that would have to be part of the package. I mean, the assumption in those circumstances would be it would have to be the Bank of England and the UK government because there is nobody else.
Well, yes, I mean, we've already discussed the fact that the Scottish government would not have access to sufficient funds to kind of back up this process. And that, of course, then brings back into sharp focus the question of the debt, because if you're going to rely on the Bank of England and the UK government to do stuff for you, right, they are going to say, well, you're going
you've
to take
the
debt, population
and
share of the debt.
Absolutely. And
yeah.
Professor Armstrong, you've got your...
So, on the transition arrangements I've already gone through, I just want to pick up on something that Owen and Ronnie touched on, this idea of a temporary or an interim or an in-between thing where you can do a bit of stonalisation until everything's calm and nobody notices and then do another change. I just don't think that's... I think if something... If you know in the medium to longer term, the best way to do this is to operate your own currency, then it's better to do that rather than go for the interim stage. Now, the reasons are, first, temporary arrangements in financial markets, as Ronnie will tell you, become very temporary if you're not careful. You know, people know there's an end to this. So having a temporary currency arrangement and expecting nobody to notice, no foreign investors or capital flight, not to think this might come to an end, you've already told them it's coming to an end. And that was the Czech-Slovak issue. They created a temporary currency union. Well, guess what? It's temporary. I'm moving my money today. So the first thing is this temporary issue is it's easy to say, but it's much harder to do in practice. The next thing is, if you go for this temporary sterlingization thing, well, in doing that, you're going to get rid of what is currently a Scottish currency called Scottish notes that you're going to have to bring back again at some point in the future. So why would you do that? And you're going to make sure everybody's contracts are going to be written into sterling when you're going to eventually one day bring in a different currency, which is going to make it even harder. So that interim one, although it kind of is kicking the can down the road and makes it look like you can just put this thing off, I think that if you would agree, and I think there probably is a consensus that for an independent country the size and sophistication of Scotland, having your own currency over the medium to longer term is the right way, it gives you most economic independence and responsibility and so on, and economic levers, then it's better that that was resolved earlier rather than leaving it later. And therefore, those institutional arrangements, and as David quite rightly pointed out, the things like redenomination were brought about sooner rather than trying to have some sort of clever way of doing a temporary fix over the short term.
But that cannot be done within 18 months.
My personal view is, as I mentioned, I think it would take 2 to 4 years to do this sort of change. Now, I picked those numbers carefully, but I think that the reason why I did that is because I think under this arrangement, it would be in the rest of the UK's interests to completely, and why wouldn't you cooperate? They did it in Ireland, it would be in everybody's interest. Nobody wants to get these banks having a difficult time. You know, 80% of them are owned by us, or one of them anyway, RBS, is owned by us. It's in our interest to make this process function smoothly, and in doing so, if people of Scotland want to have an independent country,
I understand that. What I don't quite understand is the incompatibility between that sort of 2 to 4 year period and the 18 month period. And you spoke about an interregnum, you know, temporary, but presumably from the date of a yes vote to the establishment of a new currency is going to be a period of flux and potential capital flight and gnomes, potentially taking action and all the rest of it. And I'm not quite clear how any of that can be managed successfully.
And the short answer is that we don't know for sure that it can be managed successfully. It is a risk, but you are better to have that risk managed by the government north of the border and the government south of the border working together to try and manage that risk. Does that risk disappear because of that? Of course not. There's still risks around it. There will be enormous risks in this transition. But you'd have it be in both sides' interest to try and make this work to come to a reasonable conclusion.
And what might the impact be upon my constituents' mortgages during this interregnum?
Well, first of all, it would depend on where those institutions were deciding to locate. So in what one would want, it, see, the difficulty here is that had an independent Scotland run fiscal surpluses for a number of years, so we know that, you know, in future we will have enough reserves, blah, 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 then okay. So the first thing you'd like to see is, you know, a very prudent fiscal policy to give people confidence that actually there will be these reserves built up and sound finances and so on. Without that, I think that there is a risk that some of these financial institutions decide to change their location simply to avoid what would be difficult decisions.
But that would mean, I mean, unless I'm mistaken, translated into layman's terms, that would mean that a Scottish government, which had just won a referendum for independence, would be required to introduce a programme of increases in taxes and cuts in spending in order to provide a stable currency.
That's in order to generate a fiscal surplus.
Yes.
That's what they'd have to do to get a fiscal surplus. You have to get a fiscal surplus. You have to get more income and spend less.
Right. That's not the prospectus that's being offered to people at the moment.
I can't help on that one. I'm just saying that's how you get a fiscal surplus by getting more revenue than you do spending.
Gosh, but, well, it's just in that context then, you know, I mean, I'm seeking again to clarify the impact upon my constituents' mortgages. And you know, you responded that if the Scottish Government wanted to keep mortgages and other things stable, then they would have to introduce a programme of cuts in expenditure and increase in taxes, the likelihood of which and the enthusiasm for is possibly less than total. Now, in these circumstances, that doesn't happen. What then happens to my constituents' mortgages?
Go through the roof.
Right. That's helpful to have clarification. I mean, do you agree with that, Mr. Armstrong?
Well, I'm not sure they would go through the roof. I think what would happen is, without those changes, people would question. This is before you've actually created this new currency. So in this tricky interim period, people would start to question this. You'd have a question mark of what would happen to the biggest mortgage lenders. Where would they be incorporated? And if they were not incorporated in Scotland, would they provide branch banking into the rest of, into Scotland, into this independent country? When they do this branch banking, they're going to have to make a guess about what's going to happen to the riskiness of this country, and that's going to depend on what's going to happen to the new exchange rate. Now, if this is done in a way generating fiscal surpluses, perhaps they have confidence that that exchange rate can be maintained at a reasonable level. If they don't and the deficits remain large, then presumably they won't have so much confidence and they will build, as Ronnie said, a risk premium into this, and then they would be higher.
Presumably the rational position for any mortgage provider based in England is not to touch the Scottish market with a barge pole on the basis that it's all risk and no guarantees.
Well, if you pay for this risk, so people do offer cross-border mortgages, but they if it's going to be in a separate currency, then you have to be aware that this person is going to be taking a lot of risk on, and when you give the mortgage, you know, it's quite tough to get a mortgage these days already without thinking about this person might actually have their wages and so on paid in a different currency. Is that going to be worth the same value? So
this is a through the roof observation that Professor MacDonald made, is that correct?
Well, I guess I just don't use terms like through the roof. I use terms like this would be a risk that the lender would have to price in when thinking about the mortgage that they would offer.
Right.
And if you behave very credibly and have run fiscal circuits and so on, then there's, you know, over a sustained period of time, then I think that the idea of introducing your own currency, if you have that sort of background of proven fiscal conservatism, then I think that background, then it is a possibility without all of these things happening. But if you don't have that, if you're going to introduce your own currency and you continue to run big fiscal deficits and you don't really have any meaningful FX reserves, then clearly there's risks and it would translate into higher interest rates.
Owen, you wanted to come in on that.
Yes, just very, very briefly on the sort of practicalities of new currency creation, and the point about, you know, sort of doing it quickly and any kind of transition. I completely agree, and I mean all the kind of analysts and everybody else would agree that temporary currency arrangements don't work for obvious reasons. I mean, we do have some relatively recent experience of contemplating the creation of a new currency, and that was Greece when it was, you know, possibly bowing out of the Eurozone. The practicalities around that were worked through by lots of big international banks when there was a time, it's passed now, but there was a time where it looked as if, you know, the drachma might be recreated in some form. But of course, that's a different situation to the creation of the euro itself, where there was no remaining currency. Everything was becoming the euro. And the great difficulty with, one of the issues with creating a currency sort of out of sterling is that the option will be there, certainly during any transition, to stay with sterling. In terms of the point you're making about our members not speaking out and so on, I mean, our industry, as I say, has said a lot on this issue. It may not have come through statements by companies sort of in our membership, but nonetheless, there is a lot of thinking out there. Bank of America, Merrill Lynch, Kleinwort Benson, there's a whole long list. And they are all very clear in what they say, that a currency union is not going to happen and that a new currency is the likely outcome. But to your question, would it be sensible for this committee to say, well, look, the 18-month timescale isn't practical? I know I'm stating the obvious, but I think it's worth restating. The 18-month timetable is entirely predicated on the belief, assertion, whatever you want to call it, that there will be a currency union. And I am reasonably sure that if the committee makes that kind of call, then the answer will be, but because there'll be a currency union, it will be achievable within 18 months. So I think there's a difficulty in the obviously politically pitched statements made on either side of the debate and distinguishing between them and the sort of empirical rational analysis that you see through financial analysis and the kind of analysis I think you're seeing here. So I'm not trying to tiptoe around anything, but I just think the position of the Scottish Government is that on their 18-month timescale, it's predicated on a set of beliefs, and one of them is that there will be a currency union.
Thanks. Now, can I just come back, if I could, I think the five points that you made, that you sought clarification on, you wanted to have clarification about what currency could be used. Well, I think you haven't got that. Under what terms could Scotland be a member of the EU? You haven't really got that either. What would be the effects of independence on the current single market for financial services in the UK?
We've made progress with that. We know that there would have to be a separate regulator. We know that there'd be a separate tax system. I suppose that's always been obvious. Of course, what happens to the market has to divide effectively for jurisdictional purposes into two. There is an overlay there around the currency. If you think there would be a currency union, then maybe there would be some kind of common regulatory framework at the prudential level, but at the conduct level, that is what should companies do day to day and how do they deal with customers, that would have to be done separately, introducing compliance costs separately, but also the need for separate services and products. You can't sell the same pension into Ireland, for example, as you sell it into the UK because they have different tax systems and different regulatory frameworks. So there would be a fragmentation of the current UK single market for most financial services at the retail level into two markets, and we know that that's a consequence.
So that's half a tick, is it, or a complete tick?
Well, it's not, I mean, the Scottish, you know, I make a general point. I mean, I think what the Scottish government isn't at the moment in a position to tell us all that much about what would happen post-independence, because obviously they don't know who will be in government, and we don't know the outcome of the negotiations that have sort of sat, you know, behind most of the conversation this morning. But if you look at what they say on these issues, they do say that there would remain a single market for financial services. I saw in the letter that, or in the article published yesterday in the FT, that there was reference to a common regulatory framework. I'm not sure what that really means, unless you say there is a currency union, there'll be a common banking prudential regulation. But as I say, conduct regulation, I think it's now accepted on all sides, and by the Scottish Government, even by the Scottish Government, that there would be a separate conduct regulator. So the Scottish Government continues to refer to the possibility of some sort of common regulatory structure, but I think we, and certainly everybody else, has concluded that they would, to all intents and purposes, be separate marketplaces for financial services.
I think the fourth point that you had would, how long would the transition to independence take and how would the process be managed? Do you feel you got satisfactory answers on that?
Well, there's so many unknowns. We've, as I say, made the effort to contact people who are not, you know, involved in the mm-hmm. political debate here. I think, as I said earlier, the 18-month timescale is predicated on a whole set of assumptions and beliefs, which, you know, I guess are genuinely held, but which are not necessarily held by others who would be party to that process. Certainly the EU aspects of the transition, it is clear that they would take a good while. I think it's impossible to put a date on it or a period of time. The intervention of the UK general election is clearly going to slow things down as well. So our kind of estimate would be, you know, at the upper end of 3, 4, 5 years. I mean, I can't, it's all very, very vague. Nobody knows. So in answer to your question, no, we haven't learned all that much more. But we have learned, you know, for example, that accession or the approval of all the other EU member states of whatever arrangement takes about 2 years.
And the fifth point would, what would be the requirement? What would be the requirements for financial regulation?
Yeah, so we've made some progress on that. As I say, I think it has always been clear that under EU and other international obligations, you have to have your own financial regulatory frameworks. If you're looking at a new currency, which I think, you know, those of us not already, you know, politically committed on either side would say is in the long term at least the most likely outcome, you would need all the regulatory structures, obviously including central bank and everything else. If one posits a currency union, you might envisage some very unusual arrangement if you could get away with negotiating it in the EU, but certainly the creation of a separate regulatory jurisdiction seems inescapable.
Now, we did touch earlier on in the question of lender of last resort. Are there issues related to that that people feel we haven't covered?
Only to say that the ultimate lender of last resort is always the state, unless you want to go to the IMF. It's always your own country. The central bank carries it out for you, but the people who stand behind the central bank is the government of the country.
And in the present circumstances that we're discussing, the Scottish government would be in a weak position, since it would be unable effectively to meet the financial costs of being a lender of last resort in any sort of turmoil or economic chaos, either in Scotland or across the world. Is that a fair set of assumptions?
So the for Scottish incorporated banks, the lender of last resort would ultimately be the Scottish government, because of the amount of debt. Well, if Scotland takes a fair share of the debt, then its capacity to do that is going to be necessarily limited.
And in those circumstances, the rational thing for Scottish registered banks would be to move.
That would be a factor persuading them to consider locating into the rest of the UK. So, lend of last resort.
Sorry, was that a yes? I mean, I'm.
I think that. Well, first of all, I don't run any bank, in fact. Never mind one of the two big ones, which is probably a good thing. It would be their commercial decision. But one of the serious issues would be, first of all, we have to remember that lender of last resort offers a menu of options from day-to-day transactions, which international banks from all around the world can access. So Scottish banks will be able to access that day-to-day transactions, no problem, as an independent country. The tricky bit is when you get towards financial distress and you want to have emergency lending assistance, which is where, for emergency lending assistance, the decision, according to the Memorandum of Understanding between the Bank of England and the Treasury, that decision is made by the Chancellor of the Exchequer. The Chancellor of the Exchequer will make that decision, presumably, based on the interests of his constituents, which is the UK taxpayers. Which is why, ultimately, when things get difficult, it's the state that stands behind the central bank as the lender of last resort. And when banks decide where they're going to base themselves, that will not be a small matter in their deliberation.
But, I mean, just to cut across that, if I could, I mean, in as much as I understand it, it would be rational in these circumstances for any bank to move, to have a bigger umbrella over them or arm round them or whatever metaphor you want to use, because presumably the danger for anybody in Scotland running a financial institution would be that the Scottish state would not be able to step in and support them in their hour of crisis should an hour arrive, and therefore the sense would be just to make sure you switched. Now, is that not seems perfectly reasonable?
It seems like a reasonable factor in their location. I think that the where you're incorporated, so where you would be able to, first of all, where you'd be located, where you'd be regulated, and where the government would be much more prepared, because of course they don't always offer emergency assistance to all banks, where it's much more likely to do it is within its own border, because this is taxpayers' money. And so clearly that is a strong pull to be located behind a government with strong resources. And it's no surprise when you look around the world, look at small states with big banking sectors. Hong Kong, huge reserves. Singapore, huge reserves. Well, is it Switzerland? Not as big as those two, but you know, fiscally very sound. That's not an accident.
Right. Fine. So, I mean, yes, okay. The consequences of moving. I mean, I understand the point you make about some banks being the distinction between deserving and undeserving, in the event of who would be bailed out. But I mean, coming back just to clarify then. Am I right in thinking that there would be substantial job implications for people deciding to relocate in order to have the protection? And this, you know, comes back to the point that we were touching on earlier on. The rational thing for banks to do to obtain the protection is to relocate, and the way in which the system operates means that this couldn't just simply be brass plating. It would mean substantial number of jobs moving as well, the exact number of which indetermined at the moment, and we'll maybe seek further clarification on that. But that would be the direction of travel. Does that seem
so? The incorporation or the registered office for regulatory purposes, the scenario we've been talking about would move to the rest of the United Kingdom. That doesn't mean to say you'd stop doing banking in Scotland, obviously.
No.
You then create a subsidiary or a branch to do this banking. Now, an important question, which Mr. Kelly might shed some light on, is how institutions will consider to do banking with branches rather than head offices. They're different animals. They've got different legal standing. So it's not just a simple case of, well, just move the brass plate and everything will be okay. Everything stays the same. It's not quite as simple as that. So as far as, you know, I'm no banking industry expert. All I'm saying is that your lender of last resort is always your government. And where you are registered or incorporated, the same term, according to Companies House, will determine which is the institution that does the regulations. And if one has got deep pockets and can print its own money, then that's clearly got an advantage against one that doesn't.
David?
I'm not absolutely sure about this, but it seems to me that the employment issue is a difficult one to pin down. We do have lots of institutions working in the financial sector in Scotland who aren't brass plated in Scotland. But on the other hand, my understanding, and I could be wrong, is that one of the key points will be that where the brass plate is where the liability for corporation tax resides. And that would be very important for the Scottish public finances.
Right, thanks.
Just very briefly following up, I think in general terms, if one is asking if there is a yes vote and Scotland becomes an independent country, how would large, either banks or others, insurers, how would they sort of view it as a market? I think the decision on whether to branch into the market or to have a subsidiary it's hard to generalise. It depends on the nature of the business, it depends on the volume of the business and other things. It also depends on whether it's a business that requires or has as an important part of the regulatory approval capital sort of adequacy and other things, because then different regulatory requirements come in, and of course we can make some assumptions about the regulatory requirements of an independent Scotland as a separate jurisdiction on the basis that they will be complying with EU frameworks and other things. But nonetheless, there's quite a lot of scope within jurisdictions to decide those things. There's recently a controversy in the UK about whether a Chinese bank should be allowed to be a branch or a subsidiary, for example. So there's issues there. But in general terms, I think some in our industry have indeed made it clear that if there was a yes vote, they would examine Scotland as a market, and they would then reach a decision on whether and how they should service that market. And I think
that's that, that point's been made clearly by a number of companies. So it's difficult to generalise, but I think it will be very much driven by the size of the market. I think it's reasonable to make a comparison again with Ireland. We have a number of members who operate on the basis of a UK and Ireland business unit. So they look at Ireland as a market, they look at the opportunities there, and they look at the costs, and then they decide how they will be active in that market. But in that case, they have to comply separately with Irish requirements, not only on regulation of conduct and other things, but also capital adequacy and other things. So I come back to my point about the difference between serving one jurisdiction and the difference between serving a number of jurisdictions.
Yeah, just to go back a bit, in essence what you're saying is if Scotland had been independent in 2008, we wouldn't have an RBS.
I suppose that's directed at me. So, well, you'd have to give me more information. So if people had known in 2000 that Scotland was about to be independent in 2008, then presumably RBS would never have been the size or made some of those decisions like taking over ABN AMRO in 2007. Presumably the Scots would be much wiser not to have made those daft decisions. So it's kind of hypothetical. If you said you had an institution the size and the weakness of RBS in 2008, and then Scotland was an independent country, then clearly it wouldn't have been able to stand behind it. So what would have happened is then the, we're now serious in the role of sort of imagination, but presumably in that circumstance it would have involved a number of other countries, perhaps including, we have an example, it's called Ireland. They had a very large financial system which got into very serious trouble that they couldn't afford to support.
Oh, and the SNP leader at that time was in favour of lighter touch regulation, if you recall.
The witness shrugged. I mean, it's a reasonable way of submitting that. Owen, do you want to add anything?
Not really. No. I mean, I think that's. I think that's right.
Yeah. Could I just? I'd just like to add the point about competitiveness and it's really trying to get at the question you're asking about whether firms would move. I think it's important to remember, and this isn't often brought out, if at all, in the debate, that even if we were able to achieve a formal sterling zone post-independence and remove all of the uncertainty surrounding that, still at the heart of that you would have the oil issue, and you would have important changes in competitiveness because of that. And basically, irrespective therefore of the regime that you have, you're always going to have this tension on competitiveness. And my prediction would be that any company, be it a financial institution or a non-financial institution, the proportion of trade it does with the rest of the UK, I believe that it will move its, that proportion of its business at least to the rest of the UK because of these competitiveness changes. I mean, you want to internalise these changes. You don't want oil to be affecting your business costs in Scotland as it would if Scotland became independent. So I believe that in itself would indicate that it would be rational for firms to move at least a proportion of their trade with RUK to RUK to internalise that effect.
Right. Can I just put one final point to you, if I could? This has hardly been an occasion for lightness and joy, has it? I mean, it's been all rather gloomy in terms of the prospect. I mean, how would you respond to somebody that says, look, all you're doing is just talking Scotland down? And a bit like the shipbuilding industry, that, you know, we are so good that people would, give us money and orders and everything would be fine. And, you know, you're just looking on the gloomy side and, you know, all this is just unadulterated negativism and scaremongering and everything will be fine. I mean, how do you respond to that argument? Because presumably that's an argument that's going to be put.
Well, if I can say something outspoken, as I've said before, I believe at the moment the Scottish public are being deceived. I've used the word duped by telling them that they can have a currency arrangement, which no economist that I'm aware of who studied currency arrangements would propose. That is a fact. And Therefore, it's not talking Scotland down. It's basically wanting what would be best for Scotland if Scotland were to become independent. It's very clear from all of the evidence, all the economic evidence, that a currency union is not the way to go. And I don't think that's talking Scotland down. I think that's being realistic and being honest.
Owen, I'll take Owen and Ian.
I think it's really important for every country to be able to be clear-eyed and realistic about things. I think it's dangerous to be too Pollyanna about any subject, actually. And our industry it's in the nature of what we do to try and be dispassionate and to look at numbers. And often people, you know, criticise us for that, for being sort of unimaginative or lacking in poetic imagination or whatever it might be. But I come back to all the analysis that's been published by our industry. It is very clear that a currency union is not going to happen. It is very clear that joining the EU for an independent Scotland will not be straightforward. Some go further. There's some, you know, very colourful language in some of this stuff. And they are very clear as well about the impacts on credit rating and other things. So just trying to distinguish between the things that might be said by a body like SFE in terms of representing its members in what is a pretty uncomfortable political process, and what the cold-eyed analysis of large financial institutions who do this stuff all the time for markets all around the world. They'll be doing the same thing for the impacts on, I don't know, the Russian economy, of the Ukraine crisis, or whatever it might be. And I think I tend to look to those sources for guidance rather than those which are clearly on either side of an attempt to win a particular referendum outcome.
Yeah.
Well, I think the debate, Chairman, needs to be carried out in a rational way, with the analysis of the various factors being carried out in committees such as this, and you've heard from experts here. I think that is what is important, so that the public out there have got a good set of evidence from which they can form their own judgments. Now, if there are those in business and elsewhere who have genuine concerns about the currency, about Europe, about the costs of operating across two jurisdictions, are very genuine, then, you know, I don't think that that is talking Scotland down. I think that's expressing very real concerns into the debate, but at the end of the day, it's for the people of Scotland to make up their mind by weighing the evidence that they've heard.
Either of...
Yeah, just before I came in, I was looking at the statue of Adam Smith across the street here, one of Scotland's greatest economists, but I would go to possibly a more famous other one, David Hume, one of whom's great insights was, let's look at the evidence, which seems kind of obvious now, but at a time when kings thought that they ruled by divine right and there were huge religious influences on the way that people thought, maybe was quite an insight. Anyway, it seems to me that we've tried as far as we can to look at the evidence, and the evidence is based on the history of our own country and other countries around the world. Now, that's not to say there's not a chance that the Scottish economy post-independence would be radically different and maybe much more productive. I think the evidence on that sort of thing is that reorientation of an economy, such as Ireland, for example, takes a very long time, and there's a lot of political and economic difficulty along the way. So I'm not trying to talk Scotland down in this at all, but as far as I can see, what we've been doing is looking at the evidence and trying to draw as clear conclusions as we can from that evidence.
Angus.
I would imagine that the independence debate, a lot of things other than economics matter to people, and we're just looking at one part of the economics debate, which is the currency options, and I think pointing out that one currency option looks inferior to another one, i.e. having some sort of informal currency union does not look as good as having your own currency as a way of achieving the outcome you want. I don't think there's a, personally, I think that's my professional responsibility to point that out. And that's all that we seek to do. In terms of other people's views, well, there have been surveys of international economists. There was one published last month, I think, by the Center for Macroeconomics, which is available on the website, and people can see what they think about the broader economic and the currency, actually, context. So there are other people's views. I think most of those economists in that survey, or half of them at least, are non-UK nationals. So you can see an international perspective on this as well from the Centre for Macroeconomics. My only angle is to look at the currency and debt issues, and on those alone, that's the only issue that I'm giving evidence here.
Colleagues, are there any observations that you wish to make? Any answers ungiven, sort of questions that we haven't covered? I mean, we've learned, I think, that Adam Smith and David Hume are both no voters, and Pollyanna is a yes voter. I mean, that has been valuable. But any final points that you want to make to us? If there's anything, you know, that you think of that you wish on the way home that you'd said, perhaps, you know, you could let us have something in writing. I mean, you've been denounced in the Financial Times today as an unbalanced panel. I'm not quite sure what that means, since you seem to have been reasonably balanced to me, but
quite normal to me.
And not in the sense of deranged. I mean, though possibly, well, I don't know actually what was meant by the writers of me in the Financial Times. But can I thank you very much?
I think it'd be fair to say that we've not been engaging in Project Fear, but Project Reality.
Right.
And the focus on evidence has been very helpful.
No, I think this has been very helpful for us today. We hope to have this outstreamed at some time tomorrow, so hopefully a wider audience will be aware of the sort of discussions we've had and the points we've made. Thank you very much for coming. Order, order.
Thank you. So much for getting here.